70 persons for looking into a box. Is it such a crime? But Lot, he committed incest with his daughters. He didn't do anything. You know that? Lot. Reuben, he had sex with his mother. God said nothing. Right. Judah had intercourse with his daughter-in-law. And he had the children, the great-grandfathers of your God, Jesus Christ. Children of incest. Children of incest. Your great-grandfathers of your God. In Samuel, he talks about one of the sons of David raping his sister. God said nothing. The other guy, he rapes 10 of his father's wives wholesale. And God said nothing. But for a guy looking into the box, he goes and kills 50,070 persons. Is this in the book of God? Is this God talking?
Please try this in the bin. I renounce Christianity, man. Yes, you really, you just... I don't question God. He is my Almighty Father. He has given me salvation.
No, thank you very much. Now you have to become a Muslim. God talking.
Please try this in the bin. I renounce Christianity.
That's all.
No, you said
throw it into the bin.
Okay, could I have it back?
No, you can't.
Why not?
No, you gave it to me.
I didn't give it to you.
You gave it to me to throw it into the bin.
Well, could I have it back?
No, you can't. You can't.
Please.
No, you can't.
Can I get on my knees? Please, no, I must have that back. My mom, dad gave it to me.
Just have a look at the context. I'm just
going to wrap this piece to you down. Because I've actually got a lot of work to do and I don't want to waste your time.
Me too, I'm also a very busy man. But I sacrificed my whole morning.
Thank you very much, I appreciate it. 17.
That's stealing. You see, you took that Bible out.
Yeah, no, that it's
is,
my Bible.
That is stealing.
Stealing?
That is stealing, yes. Like, you see,
please, look, may I ask for my Bible back?
You took it from there, that is stealing. I just absented myself for 2 seconds, and this is what you do. You are a man of spirit, a spiritual person. You said, I renounce Christianity. I'm quoting your words. And he says, throw this in the dustbin.
I was joking. I was frustrated.
No, that's what you said. Now you must be a man of your word. As a spiritual person, you had no right to pick it up. Okay. That was stealing.
Please, may I have my Bible back?
No. Please, to me. No. Give it Seven to me. Give, no.
I want my Bible.
No.
Eight years old.
Is that King James?
No, it's a New International Version. I've got a King James at home as well.
Right.
I use about 3 different Bibles when I do study scripture.
Yes.
Do you have a Bible? If you want to get your Bible out there. I do the same thing, but word for word gets a bit difficult. Through chapters 3, about 16 through to about 20, leading up to the trial.
You're speaking you too fast. I think your English is a bit too fast.
Oh, apologies.
For me.
Okay.
This machine is an old machine. You know, it takes a little.
Okay, we'll just slow down a bit,
please.
From chapters 16 through 20, we see that.
Chapter 16 of John.
John, chapter 16 through to about 20, we see Christ has been accused of something they claim he's not, whereas he claims to be the King of the Jews, and then he was tried, and then taken up to Golgotha and crucified.
Just 1 second.
1 minute. You should have seen this.
Okay, no problem.
This will cover. I'll bring you. Okay.
There's one thing I find quite quite, it wasn't amusing, although it wasn't always this gentleman, Ahmadidat, is very, very militant.
Yeah. Where did you see him?
No, in the literature, a lot of things.
He got a booklet on crucifixion.
He
got a literature on crucifixion.
He's incredibly militant. I could imagine him with an AK-47 in his hand. Ooh, he was like, and his statements are so very, he's like so convicted, it's like almost as if he wants to go to war over it.
Yeah, it's okay.
Like Jesus Christ. He said, you generation of vipers, you whited sepulchres, you wicked and adulterous generation. You fools.
He said,
you fools. He said, you fools. Did he?
In what context?
No. But he used
in
all
what
this
context?
He used all this language.
Yeah,
he
but
said,
it went.
Oh, generation of vipers. You know what that means?
Where's this? Where is it in the Bible? I'm not familiar with it. I have heard it, but where is it?
No, please don't. These are expressions which are so common in the Bible, in the New Testament. You generation of vipers.
Where does it say this specifically? No, I just want to find a place. The thing is, can we just get something straight? I'm not coming here to argue.
I'm coming here out of my own curiosity. No, what happens now? It seems so strange that you are a Bible enthusiast.
Yes.
And this expression is biblical. Ye generation of vipers.
Wait, no, we just say this.
You never heard that?
Not out of the Bible.
Well, then I'll just find it for you.
No, I'd like you to, because I don't know where it is. No, this is not like, you know, I'd like to know where it is, because I don't know.
Wicked and adulterous generation.
Yeah, I know that.
Where?
I've heard that.
Where?
I'm not too sure, I can't remember. I've just read it several times.
Right. You fools. You fools.
Where does he say that?
Matthew 3:7. Look for it, my son. Matthew 3:7. Right. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, brood of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Matthew 12:34.
Okay, so I'm just reading this.
Brood of vipers. You know what that means?
So I'm just reading the context of the whole scripture.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right, okay, I understand. This is John we're talking about, he said this.
Huh?
John said this.
Oh. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But this is who has spoken, right?
Isaiah, right?
And John himself was clothed in camel's hair in Jerusalem all Judea, and then were baptized by him. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and said that he is coming to his baptism, he said to them, brood of vipers. Matthew 12:34. Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of abundance of the heart, mouth speaks. Matthew 3:7.
Okay.
Right, or else. This one is, and if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, or else how can one enter the strong man's house? He who is not with me is against me. Therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy, anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whosoever speaks also, either make the tree good and who is right. Brood of vipers. Now this is the words of Jesus.
So where are you reading from now? You lost
verse 34.
Verse 34.
Yeah.
Okay, you brood of vipers, etc. Yeah. Come in. Oh, then you're going for that sign of Jonah, from that sign of Jonah.
No, not.
Or just from verse 34 right through
verse 34 37. Says, you generation of vipers. In another version, it says, you generation of vipers.
Yeah, I've got you.
You brood of vipers. What is brood of vipers?
What do you call it? A nest of snakes.
Right, you snakes. Yeah. Is that a very complimentary thing to say about anybody?
Why was he saying what he said?
You, as a preacher, in your congregation, preacher, to your congregation, they're going off.
What about some tea for this gentleman?
Nothing for me, thanks. I just grabbed a cup of coffee down at cafe. Thank you very much, I appreciate it.
You see, you're talking to your congregation.
Okay.
In other words, you're trying to sell yourself, your ideas, making them to bring them towards God and towards righteousness.
Same, but no, I wouldn't.
You address them as you brood of vipers.
No, I wouldn't. No.
You wicked and adulterous generation. Will you address them?
Well, what I'm trying to say is, why did he say this? It's not what he's saying.
Right. I tell you why. The people come to him. They said, "Master, look at me.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just.
No, you can't. You look. The human mind can't do two things at the same time.
I'm brilliant. I can do three things at once. No. I'll eat.
You must be a monkey. No. It's a monkey brain that you know. You can do this and you can do that.
Okay. So I'm listening.
You are lying to me. Because the psychologists say the human mind can't think two things at the same time.
Okay.
You can't be listening and reading at the same time.
My subconscious is recording what you're saying.
That's different. But now you can't be thinking.
Yeah, you're saying.
This is what your psychologists say.
Yeah.
Right. So now they come to him.
Yes.
And they said, "Master," in the Hebrew language, Rabbi.
Yes, Rabbi.
Very respectable. Very respectable. We would have a sign of thee. We would like you to show us a miracle to convince us that you are the man we are waiting for.
Okay.
Now, to me, it's a legitimate request.
Oh, okay.
Now, like you come along, you're claiming for a parcel, or you go to the post office. You see a Gavan. That's your first name.
Yes.
A registered parcel comes in your name.
Okay, yes, I understand.
And you go to the post office with a slip. They say, "We want your identity." Is it a valid request?
No, definitely. Yes.
Because it will be anybody could have picked up that slip.
Anyone could take that slip.
They want to know that you are Gawan.
Yes.
And we want to give you the parcel, but we want your identity.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So now you turn on the guy and say, "You bastards, you know, I am Gavan. I know I am Gavan. You know, the whole world knows me."
Yeah.
"And damn it all, you're asking me." You don't do that. They are asking, there is a valid request. He's asking you for your identity.
Yeah.
And he's prepared to give you the parcel. But just show me your identity. You are Gavan, then sign in front of me.
And I'll get the parcel.
And get the parcel.
Okay.
So, Jesus Christ, he claims that he is the Messiah. The Jews are not satisfied.
Okay.
You know, with his verbal assertion, you know, clay. They want some certificate, some proof.
Guaranteed.
They want some proof. So, and in their minds, proof is doing something miraculous. That means now, look, what I can't do, if you can do, then I can give you credit that maybe you are appointed by God. Like walking on the water, flying in the air, giving life to the dead. Do something, man, that we can't do. And that will be a certificate enough.
A sign that he is the Messiah, who he says he is.
Correct.
Okay.
So, to me, it's a valid request. But Jesus, you know, he gets angry, gets frustrated, and he says, "O wicked and adulterous generation, seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it, except the sign of the prophet Jonah.
Yeah.
For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth."
Sorry?
They want a sign. The first thing is that he had no right to get flabbergasted. You know, he had no right. The man is asking you a simple, says, "Excuse me, sir, can I have a look at your identity?" The postman is asking you.
Yes.
You don't have to go and blow your top and swear and start abusing that guy. He's only doing his duty. These people, they are representative of the people, and they said, "Look, if you are claiming to be something supernatural, the Messiah, supposed to be something supernatural, so in that case we want to see some miracles that you perform.
Something solid.
That we can do." See? So Jesus says, "O wicked and adulterous generation," in common parlance, in today's language, he would be saying, he would be saying, "Your bastard nation." You know how we talk today, you know?
Yeah.
He says, "Your bastard nation," you know? "You're looking for a sign, you want a miracle, and I'll give you no miracle." Read it.
Yeah, no, I don't mean to be like profound, but you've taken everything you said totally out of context.
Right, what is the context, my son?
Okay, first of all, if you read the whole of this, okay, from verse 22.
Right, let me see. Verse 22. Now, if you look at
the
verse 22.
The whole context of that passage from verse 22 right through to verse 37. If you take that verse, you brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. If you take that verse on its own,
right.
Yes, I agree with you. But you cannot take that verse and accuse Jesus of anything because of what he says in the entire context of that passage. He has a reason for saying that. And then secondly, in verse 39, when he answered, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. As for as Jonah was 3 days, etc., etc., he never accused them. He never said to you, you are a wicked generation. He said, a wicked generation. He didn't point fingers. He didn't specify who the wicked generation was. He simply said, a wicked generation asks for miraculous sign. Does it say, you who are a wicked generation, or you the wicked generation, or anything like that? I don't believe in any way he was pointing or prescribing any of those people who asked him for a miraculous sign as being the wicked generation that he meant, that he talks about. And then he says, but none will be given.
Wait. The people who are asking him are a generation.
Yes, but does he prescribe them to be that generation?
Wait. And that generation is asking for a sign.
Yes, sir.
So he's now addressing them. An evil and adulterous generation, a bastard nation, is looking for a sign.
Could he not have also been talking about the generation?
Damn it all, you, when the guy is asking you for your identity.
No, I don't believe that the example stands firmly.
No. When you're asking you for your identity, and you say your government, is laying out such rules, nonsensical rules.
Yeah, etc.
You are implying that worker for the government is also lumped in. He is working for the government, isn't he?
Okay.
Right.
So the guy,
whoever comes to you and is telling you, Master, very, very humble.
Yeah. Respectful.
He says, Sir, Priest, Parson, Predicant. He's telling like that. He says, look, we would like to have a sign from you. Show us something then. So he says, an evil and adulterous generation, the one who's asking.
Yeah.
Seeketh for a sign. An evil, whoever it is, anyone, he's asking for a sign is an evil and adulterous generation. It's anybody, everybody, who's going to do such a thing.
But my question is to who is he saying?
Who heard this? Who heard these words? Who is he addressing to? Is he talking to the wall?
Yeah, but what I'm
Is he talking to the world?
No, he's talking to the people that asked him the
right.
question.
So now he's addressing them. You are an evil and adulterous.
Look at the way he says what he says. He answered, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a miracle sign, but none will be given. He is not saying, you who are a wicked and adulterous generation. He is saying, those who are wicked. He is just saying, he is not talking to anyone specifically. He is making a statement.
Look, you are a Welsh. I don't know. You see, you are not an Englishman.
No, I'm not English.
You're not English. Well, you're Welsh.
Welsh.
No. There's a big difference. The Englishman, he knows his language. You see, A is an indefinite article.
Okay, no, I agreed.
I don't know, in Welsh is that.
No, it's the same. English is English.
Mm-hmm. No, your Welsh English might be different.
No, I don't
you
think
so. You see, A is an indefinite article.
Yes.
Means anybody, everybody.
No, it doesn't mean everybody. It means
anybody. It doesn't mean everybody. Anybody who makes such a request.
Yeah.
Not necessarily you, but you are included. Anybody who makes a request asking me to perform something.
No, then you would have had to use the word the wicked generation and not a.
No.
I'm being serious now. If you want to get grammatical, fine.
Maybe this man's English. Right. Just
you see, the Englishman has made it easy.
Right.
For people who are not born of English tongue.
Right.
Who have not gone English. They've come out with a today's English version. Today's English version.
Right. So today's English version.
That's right. So this is to...
But this guy doesn't accept that.
No, hang on. Huh? I'm seeing from a layman's point of view. Right. This is to help people
right.
to understand simple things that are said in certain way in the Bible because people didn't speak English that way.
Right.
So you say to somebody, so-and-so laid with so-and-so.
Right.
So now you say, now what does he mean laid?
Right.
So when you open this one,
he said it had sex.
This one says it had intercourse.
Right.
So if you take that particular verse.
Right.
And now this is got today's English version, uh-huh. the Good News Bible.
Good News Bible. Yeah. You know
the word.
You have it.
Yeah. Then some of the teachers of the law and some Farsi spoke up. Teacher, they said, we want to see you perform a miracle.
Right.
39, that's the verse you're looking at.
Right.
How evil and godless are the people of this day.
Right.
That's
right.
What he's talking, not a different gen, of this day.
Right.
Jesus exclaimed,
right.
You ask me for a miracle?
You no. ask me for a miracle?
No, the only miracle you will be given is the miracle of the prophet Jonah.
Right.
Verse 40, in the same way that Jonah spent 3 days and nights in the big fish, so will the Son of Man spend 3 days and nights in the depths of the earth. So coming back to your question, which generation he was referring to?
Okay, he's talking that about makes that. It fantastically how evil people will agree that he was talking to
the people of this day.
This day?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
How evil and godless are people today? See, when people are talking to
right.
you, say this young man is complaining to you about how today youngsters are smoking about drugs.
Right.
And you say, well, how evil are our children today?
Right.
Our children today.
Right.
Means you're talking to that generation.
Right.
So that's what it is here.
Yeah, man. Okay.
So he's referring to that generation.
Right. But now, you know, this little thing gets stuck in his throat, Gowan's throat. You know, I don't know whether we can proceed at all. You know, look, simple, basic language.
Yeah.
He's telling you, the man is addressing you, addressing me, then I start addressing you.
Yeah.
Says, you know, nation. Actually, I'm implying you, you know, by you making such a silly request. I said, people, you know, they make such a... I'm actually swearing you, but you know, in a
you're talking in a context,
right?
Generalized.
Right. But it implies you because you are the
because
one.
I'm a part.
You are the guy who's asking
yes.
for a sign.
Okay.
Right. So he is abusive to the elders of his people because we are told they are scribes and Pharisees, right?
Okay.
And they came with a simple, elementary request: your identity, your proof.
Yeah.
Right. Then he does give a proof. He just gives a proof. And that is, he says, the sign, the miracle. Sign means a miracle.
Yes.
Not road
well,
sign.
Well, not necessarily a miracle, but a sign.
Yeah. What you're reading there, that sign means a miracle.
Miracle, yeah.
Yeah, okay. In this particular context.
No.
Some of the...
Then what are you...
We want to see you perform a miracle.
Yeah, okay.
Now, is that a mistranslation?
No, I'm saying in this context, yes.
But now, what?
Required.
Then why the hell, you know, you're just trying to be difficult? What?
No, I'm sorry, apologize.
I'm telling you, sign means miracle.
Yeah.
What I would suggest, what I would suggest, you don't blame him. He's a young man now. He's defensive.
Which is nature of
people.
Right.
There's nothing wrong. He's defensive. So what happens is, he's sitting on guard, and when you say,
sign.
Did Jesus say that?
He says,
maybe my Lord didn't say that.
Right.
Let me just check where it is.
Right.
So what I would suggest, let me give you a piece of paper. Just make notes of your questions.
Aha.
Here, Mr. Dida talk.
Well, I've got questions.
And then you can come back and say, you know, when you said that with signs, were you referring to miracle or signs? So at least the discussion will get going.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you won't get further than
one
verse.
Very good.
You won't get further than
very
one
good.
Verse.
Very good.
No, I agree with you on this point. The fact that they were asking for a miracle and then later on he says, accept the sign of the prophet Jonah, agreed that this is a miracle is required to prove his identity.
Right.
Like I said, that's not my intention is to try and prove anybody wrong. I base my life on the Bible.
So now Jesus says, the only sign I'm going to give you, miracle, is the sign of the prophet Jonah.
Okay.
Meaning, what happened to Jonah is going to happen to me. What happened to Jonah, the miracle of Jonah is my miracle. The sign of Jonah is my sign. The sign that they want, the miracle that you'll use. The miracle that you want to see.
Yeah.
Whatever Jonah did, you will see that in me.
No, I think you're taking it a bit out of context there.
Now, what is the context? You tell me now.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
The very fact that you're saying, what is the... You're disagreeing with me.
Generation asked for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and nights three days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish. So the Son of Man will be three days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Right. The only comparison, the only way the two miracles are alike is the fact that Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale, and so Jesus Christ was 3 days and three nights in the earth. There is nothing, in no way does Jesus Christ intend to imply that he would be in 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale, or that he would be like Jonah, apart from the fact that he would be 3 days and three nights, be somewhere out of vision of people, you know, no one would see him there. Do you understand what I'm saying?
They are looking for a miracle.
Yeah, and that is the miracle he's going to give them.
Keep that with you. This will also help you.
Okay, thanks.
You see, this one says, it's the same thing that you are saying, but it's so simple. Jesus, you ask me for a miracle? No, the only miracle you will be given is the miracle of the prophet. In the same way that Jonah spent three days and nights.
In the same way.
Yeah, I'll say for as Jonah was.
For as means?
Easier for you.
In your language. For as Jonah was.
In the same way.
Same way.
Yeah.
So now, you see, Gowen, you stay in a room for 3 days and three nights. Is that a miracle?
No, of course not. Because anyone can come into the room and see
No. You get out of sight of people for 3 days and three nights. Is that a miracle?
No, of course not.
No. Miracle is an impossibility. You see, a miracle is an impossibility.
Yeah. How do you qualify Jonah's, what happened to Jonah, as a miracle? How do you, this is my question. How do you qualify that as a miracle?
I should.
Okay, I'm going to write that down. Carry on. I'm listening.
You see, miracle is an impossibility. Like a man collapsing, and we shout for a doctor. The doctor comes and certifies the man dead.
Yeah.
Another man comes along, a godly person, a saint. Jesus comes along, and he says, "Thalitha kumi, damsel, arise."
Yeah.
And the person wakes up.
Yeah.
Was certified dead.
Mm-hmm.
The person wakes up.
Uh-huh.
From the dead, we say it's a miracle.
Okay.
Impossible. Because the person is certified.
Something that seemed couldn't happen did happen.
Right. Impossibility.
Yes.
That's a miracle. But after 3 days, Lazarus was dead for 3 days.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus brings him back to life.
Uh-huh.
That's a greater miracle.
Yes. Well, we consider it greater because he was dead a longer time.
3 days, you see?
Yeah.
That's a greater miracle. So the greater the impossibility, the greater the miracle.
Okay.
Right. But if the man was dead and buried for centuries, the bones have rotted in the grave,
yeah,
and that guy is resurrected, that's still a greater miracle.
By our standards.
By any standard.
I know, by human standards. I don't think God would see it the same way.
No.
The fact is, when you get down to the basics, is the man died and he was re-lifed. Life was put into him again.
So, you just died now, and if I wake you up now, it's a miracle.
Okay.
Right. But after 3 days, it's a greater miracle.
Yeah, okay, we'll call it that. But 100 years, it's even a greater miracle.
Right.
Okay.
So the greater the impossibility, the greater the miracle.
Okay, if we want to put a degree of a level of miracle.
No, it's a natural thing, sinner. The miracles of Jesus Christ, you would say, are superior to those of Moses. You know, Jesus gave life back to the dead. Moses did only certain thing. Right? Was this prophet and that prophet did it certain thing, but Jesus, he gave life back to the dead, and this is the prerogative of God.
Hmm.
And he did it. After 3 days, Lazarus came back to life.
Okay.
So, you said, no. If Muhammad gave life back to the dead girl, she had just died, maybe she was in a coma, and Muhammad revived her.
Yes.
We would claim that it was the miracle of Muhammad. Yeah. But you say, no, my Jesus, he gave life back to Lazarus after 3 days.
Okay.
So that is a greater miracle. So according to human logic, reasoning, I will have to agree with you that is greater.
Yeah.
Somebody else comes along and said, look, my prophet, he brought back the people from the dead after centuries.
Okay.
So
he's agreed.
We have to concede that is the greater miracle.
So we are taking a degree and increasing, saying the fact is that he was 100 years later that he was resurrected.
That's a greater miracle. So
they
want a miracle from Jesus, and Jesus is the only sign, only miracle I'm going to show you.
Yes.
Is the miracle of Jonah. That for as Jonah was.
Yeah. 3 days and three nights.
3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be. Just like that. 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. So I'm asking a simple question, what was that sign? What was that miracle of Jonah? What was impossible things that he did?
Yeah, that's the question I wanted to ask, because, okay, I'll answer your question because you asked me now. In my mind, the question I wrote down was, how do you qualify Jonah's being in 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale as a miracle? Does it seem human, logically human, that a man could survive for 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale?
No.
So that, therefore, by that, that would qualify it as a miracle, right?
Beautiful. Beautiful.
Fantastic. Beautiful. Okay. Beautiful. Now,
no, look, we have to be reasonable, Governor.
Yeah.
Jesus said, seek ye the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Yeah.
Right. It's not you trying to catch me out, I'm trying to catch you out. There's no thing. We must cooperate with one another.
Look, fantastic.
What you said just now, beautiful. Now, I will show you
that
the miracle of Jonah is three times over. Three times over.
What do you mean?
I'll explain to you. You see, Jonah was sent to the Ninevites. God Almighty tells him, go to Nineveh and warn the people.
Because they're a wicked city.
That they must repent in sackcloth and ashes, humble themselves before the Lord.
Yes.
Jonah is despondent. You know, he feels that those materialistic people of his time, like the materialistic people of Jesus' time, they're asking for a sign. Those people, they'll make a mockery of him. They'll laugh him out. So instead of going to Nineveh, he goes to Joppa, modern Jaffa.
Jaffa, yes. Okay.
And he takes a boat and is running away to Tarshish.
He's running away.
Right. At sea, there is a storm. And according to the superstitions of these people, anybody who runs away from his duty, from his master's command, creates such a turmoil at sea.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I understand what you're saying. Yes. Out of superstition, they believe the storm would come.
Right, right. And the storm is not abating.
Mm-hmm.
So they began to question, who can be responsible, you know, for this storm?
This is the miracle you're talking about, what happens to Jonah.
So Jonah remembers that he is derelicting his duty.
Mm.
God told him to go to Nineveh and is running away. So God is after his blood.
Well, so God wants to speaking.
Yes. So God wants to kill him.
Yes.
So in the process he's going to sink the boat. And these innocent people will die.
As well. Because of the consequence of what he did.
Correct. So Jonah volunteers that, look, I'm the guilty man. Throw me overboard and it'll be all right for you.
Yeah.
That's the book of Jonah.
Yes.
Right. So they say, no, man, you are such a good man, you know, such a holy man. Since you got into the boat, we have seen you prayerful. You know, always praying, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, praise be the Lord, praise the Lord. We see you are a good man. Maybe you want to commit suicide. You know, you want us to help you to commit suicide. See, no, we have our own system of finding out right from wrong, which is called casting of lots, which is like head or tail.
Yes.
Right, tossing of the coin.
Tossing of the coin.
Right. So according to the system, they started their way of tossing the coin, and it came to the turn of Jonah, that Jonah was a guilty man. So they took him and they threw him overboard.
Okay.
Right. Now the question arises that when they threw him overboard, was he dead or was he alive?
Well, I'm not presuming he was alive.
To help you, the man had volunteered. When a man volunteers, like you now, you say, uncle, look, if you are very busy, I'll come some other time. Right?
Yes.
I said, no, my son, sit down, man. You know, shall I get you some tea, some coffee? And then while we are chatting, an urgent call comes along.
Okay.
And I wanted immediately. So I said, God, please forgive me, my son. You know, I have an urgent call. Come some other time.
Okay, great.
Okay. You say, all right, uncle, you know, because you had already volunteered.
Yes, right. To come up by
now. Because you had volunteered, I don't have to catch you by the scruff of your neck.
And throw me out.
I said, you bastard, you know, you people are not considering other people's time, and this and that, you just come on, barge in any time, of, you know, no prior appointment. I don't have to do that, because you had already offered
your... There's an agreement.
We had already offered. He said, uncle, if you are busy, I'll come some other time.
Yeah.
And it was my insistence. Sit down, my son, man. You know, I've got endless time. But okay, something happened, and now I have to leave. I have to ask you.
Okay.
I don't have to strangle you. I don't have to, you know, twist your arm. You know, it's a comfortable bastard. You know, get out of
freely, so I'll live freely.
Beautiful. So when they threw him overboard, they didn't have to strangle him.
They
didn't have to spear him. They didn't have to force any force because the man volunteered.
Mm.
So they threw him overboard. Okay. The man was alive. Okay. They didn't kill him before throwing.
They didn't need to.
They didn't need to. And the storm subsides. Perhaps it was a coincidence. A fish comes and gobbles a man.
Okay.
A fish is not a respecter of person.
No,
to say, you know, you Jonah, you are a prophet of God. Come, my child. gently.
Yeah.
No. It's a fish is a fish. You find some, you know, the shark. How the shark.
Yeah.
You'll kill the man.
Okay.
You'll kill the man. So, when the fish swallowed him, was he dead or was he alive? He was still alive.
Okay.
Right. From the fish's belly, he prays to God for help.
Mm-hmm.
Do dead people pray?
No, of course not.
So he was still alive.
Alive, okay.
3 days and three nights, the fish takes him around the ocean, alive.
Yes.
On the third day, vomits on the seashore, still alive.
Uh-huh.
It's a miracle three times over. See, reason it. Throwing a man into a raging sea, he ought to die.
Mm.
If he died, it's not a miracle. We expect the man to die.
He was alive, so it's a miracle, right.
It's a miracle. If he died, it's not a miracle. Like me taking a gun, you know,
pulling the trigger, and
putting six shots through your heart. You know? And if you died, there's nothing miraculous about that.
I'm dead. That's right. But if I survived.
But not only survive, you know, you laugh at us, your heart is torn to pieces.
Yeah.
And you're still laughing and joking, say, uncle, where are you, man, you're tickling me. It's a miracle. It's a miracle.
Yeah.
Because we expect you to die. If you died, it's not a miracle. We expect the man to die, Jonah.
Yeah.
And if he died, it's not a miracle. Right. Because he didn't die, it's a miracle.
Right. Great.
A fish comes and gobbles the man, he ought to die. If he died, it's not a miracle. He didn't die, it's a miracle.
Okay.
3 days and three nights, suffocation and heat in the whale's belly.
Yeah.
The man ought to die. He ought to die. If he died, it's not a miracle. He didn't die, it's a miracle.
Yeah.
It's a miracle three times over.
In fact, it's a miracle that I think four times over because the whale spats him out on the shore. He could have...
No. The thing is alive. The thing is the most important. Jesus said, for as Jonah was, just like Jonah, what happened to Jonah is going to happen to me.
Uh-huh.
The miracle of Jonah is my miracle.
Okay.
His miracle is three times over.
Yeah.
Now, Jonah is alive for 3 days and three nights.
Okay.
According to your church, Jesus in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. Was he dead or was he alive?
He was dead. In body.
No. Man, when we talk about death, and he gave up the ghost. You remember on the cross?
John
the Bible says, and he gave up the ghost. In other words,
He died.
So now when you say he died. You don't say, no, it's only the separation of the soul. That is, damn it all, when your grandfather died, that is what you call, your grandfather is dead, I take it, go on.
Yeah.
He said, he's not dead. You know, it's only his soul was separated from... I said, look, please, man, don't try to be, you know, funny.
I see what you're saying.
You see, the man is dead, being the body and the soul separated. Is dead.
Uh-huh.
That woman, Salitha Kumi, damsel arise, you know Jesus rose.
Uh-huh.
So look, she was dead. The soul had come out.
Uh-huh.
That was dead. So that was a miracle. Lazarus, 3 days and three nights, the soul was separated.
Yes.
The soul doesn't die. We believe the soul is there. You see?
Yeah.
But it's the body separated from the body, we call it death. So 3 days and three nights, Jonah was alive.
Right.
Then we expect him to be dead. Jesus for 3 days and three nights, he was dead.
Mm.
Now, in your language, your English,
okay.
Go on, is that like Jonah or unlike Jonah? For he says, for as Jonah was, wagubak chengo Jonah, want suas Jonah. Suas Jonah in Afrikaans, just like Jonah.
Yes.
Wagubak chengo Jonah in Zulu. In every language of the world, it is so clear, for as Jonah was, like Jonah, and that Bible, new Bible, you know, New English Bible,
yeah.
It tells you more clearly that it will be just like Jonah. So, you are telling me that according to your belief, Jesus was dead. And according to your belief, Jonah was alive. But Jesus said he'll be like Jonah.
So you're telling me now Jesus is a liar for
what he said? I'm not telling you.
You're
English. You see, this is your language.
Yeah.
This is not Greek.
Yeah, Greek.
Or Arabic. Right? The man said, I will be like Jonah. And it's a miracle, the miracle of Jonah. The only miracle he performed in that whole book of Jonah was this. There's no other miracle he performed. Do you know that? The only miraculous thing about Jonah is that when they threw him into the raging sea, he's alive. Fish gobbles him alive. 3 days and three nights, he's alive. That's a miracle of a miracle of a miracle. Three times over. And Jesus said, my miracle that you want to see is that of Jonah. What happened to Jonah is going to happen to me. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth, just like Jonah. You are telling me now that Jonah was alive and Jesus is dead. He was dead.
So
I want to know in your language, your English, your Welsh, is that like Jonah or unlike Jonah?
Well, I think you have taken what happens to Jonah totally out of context and tried to twist the whole
thing. You tell me what is the context. Come on, give me the context.
Listen here. In the same way that Jonah spent 3 days
in the same way.
Did I finish what I was saying, please? In the same way that Jonah spent 3 days and nights in the big fish, so will the Son of Man spend 3 days and three nights in the depths of the earth. Now, it doesn't matter whether Jonah was alive or dead or Jesus Christ was alive or dead. The fact is that both of them spent 3 days and three nights somewhere in a miraculous state. You'll agree? You'll agree with me?
Can
I finish what I was
saying? The miraculous state, that is the heart of the matter. You see, the stress is on miraculous.
I hear what you're saying, but you've taken it right out of context.
No, you tell me, man. You are an English speaking person.
No,
if I call a native, English speaking native from the street, he will be able to see, man, that you're talking like a loony. By God.
You're going to great depths over something that is totally irrelevant and arbitrary.
No, Jesus Christ is emphasizing. He's going out of his way to give them a sign. And look at me. He's emphasizing, for as Jonah was, look, 3 days and three nights,
yes,
in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. He's going out of his way. He uses the word three, four times. You notice that? Just like that. And you said just now, the miraculous nature.
Okay.
The miraculous nature is Jonah being there, being alive, that's miraculous. Uh-huh. Just being 3 days and three nights, I locked you in a cell.
Mm-hmm.
There's no miracle about that.
Of course.
Right? Or in a chest for 3 days, and if you survive, you know, there's no miracle about that.
Mm-hmm.
The only miracle is that when you expect a man to die and he doesn't die.
Okay.
Same thing should happen to Jesus. We expect him to die. See, if he died, no miracle. For example, you know, a guy punched him in the stomach at the trial.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing miraculous about that.
No.
Somebody lands him on the side with a spear. Mm-hmm. Nothing miraculous about
that. He was dead at that time anyway.
So he had beating and all that, what not, you know. So I said, look, there's nothing miraculous about that. You know, the guy beating him, telling him, come on, prophesy, who hit you.
Mm-hmm.
The miracle is that we expect Jesus to die. If he died, it's not a miracle. If he didn't die, it's a miracle.
No, that's absolute trap. That's rubbish. That's junk.
We expect Jonah to die.
No, sorry, you have taken the whole scripture out of context and twisted it for your own means. Because the whole fact is, everything that Jesus Christ is trying to say here is not the fact that...
No, what he's trying to say? You tell me, what he's trying to say?
Look at the context of what he's trying to say.
Go ahead, give me the context.
What he's saying is here, is they asked for a miracle, right? You'll agree with me. They asked for a sign.
Right. Miracle.
Okay, we'll say a miracle, sign, witness, it's the same thing.
Right.
They asked for a miracle.
Uh-huh.
To prove that who he was. He said, the only sign you shall receive is that I will die for 3 days and three nights.
He didn't say I will die. Don't put words there, damn it all, man. Where have you got the word die there?
Well,
What right here?
Okay.
Where did he say I will die?
So will the Son of Man spend three days and nights in the depths of the earth. Okay, why would he go into the earth for 3 days and three nights other than if he was dead? What kind of miracle if he went now, disappeared underground for 3 days and three nights,
right,
and came up and said, here I am again, what kind of miracle would that be?
If he remained.
That is no miracle, you'll agree with me. That is no miracle.
The miracle of Jonah is that he went
and forget about Jonah now. I'm talking
about Jesus. Can you forget about Jonah? When you're Jesus Christ, you're God, damn it all, he's emphasizing the thing, and the only sign is that I'm going to give you.
Three days and three nights.
Right. So now you agreed with me that the 3 days and three nights keeping you in a cell, that's not
a miracle, right?
Right. But if I put you to some kind of sausage machine, and you come out on the other side, you were supposed to come out as a sausage. But instead of that machine, it turns everything into sausage, pigs and dogs and donkeys, anything.
Whatever.
And now you put in and you come out as you went in. So we say it's a miracle.
Okay.
Because we expect you to become a sausage and you didn't become a sausage.
Okay.
We expect Jonah to be dead and he didn't die. It's a miracle.
Mm-hmm.
Right. We expect Jesus also to die from the treatment that he had received.
Which he did.
So if he died, it's not a miracle.
That is the most nonsensical lot of junk I've ever. What happened 3 days after he was there? What happened? What was the whole crux?
No, for 3 days and three nights. He didn't say what happens afterwards. You know, look, afterwards Jonah may have got married.
That is where I'm coming. That is the point I'm heading at. But you're not actually giving me the chance
Go ahead, my son. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, you keep saying that's no miracle.
No, I want you to be reasonable, consistent. You see?
Yeah.
Don't get flabbergasted.
Yeah.
Right. You know, be calm.
I'm calm.
Right. So we say now that the miracle of Jonah was that he's alive for 3 days and three nights.
Okay.
Jesus is dead for 3 days and three nights. We expect him to die.
Okay.
And he died.
Yeah.
So it's not a miracle.
But you've taken like half the story. The half. Okay.
3 days and three nights.
I agree with you. What he says here. The only way, that's why I said the only way that his miracle and the miracle that happened to Jonah compare is the fact that for 3 days and three nights they were out of the sight of human beings. There was no
one. Is that a miracle?
There's no one
I'm
getting to what I'm going to say.
Right.
You'll agree with me that is the only way the two miracles compare is that Jesus Christ was dead for 3 days and three nights. The fact is, 3 days and three nights, Jesus was dead, and 3 days and three nights, Jonah was in the belly of a whale.
Alive! Alive.
The fact whether he was alive or dead is irrelevant in this case.
Damn it all, you agreed with me that it's a miracle that Jonah is alive.
Yeah, but...
Do you agree with me?
Yes.
Okay. Look, I said it's a miracle three times over.
That's not the point.
When you throw a man into a raging sea, the man ought to
die. Okay, we've discussed this.
He didn't die.
I've agreed with you, we've discussed this.
So now, once you've agreed with that,
okay,
it's a miracle of a miracle of a miracle.
Etc.
Right. And Jesus wants to emphasize that very fact.
Okay. No, I don't believe that. You're wrong.
No, you really just
done. No,
for as Jonah was, as Jonah was, 3 days and three nights.
3 days and three nights. Listen to me. He says, in the same way that Jonah
was
not alive in the big fish, or does he say...
In the same way. Look, do you understand English?
Yes. No, but you...
Is that Welsh? Is that Welsh you're reading?
It's perfect English.
Right. So he said, in the same way. In the same way that Jonah was alive.
Okay. So no, he doesn't say alive.
Right. Or right in the
three
same way. The miracle
in the big fish.
Right.
Alive, so, dead, rotting.
Right. But the miracle. Suppose the man went into the fish's belly.
Okay.
Right. And he died. Is that a miracle?
Obviously not, because no one would ever seen him again.
No. Right. Finish. So in other words, the miracle is the impossibility. You agreed with me, Gowen, that the impossibility...
Yeah, in that context, but then you've taken this verse out of... In making all that point, you have taken this out of context, because that is not the point that Jesus is making here.
What point is he making?
The point, the entire fact, everything that Jesus is saying here is the fact that 3 days and three nights, that is the only way, Jonah's miracle, and this is what happened to Jesus. Read there.
Which one?
Days and three nights.
38.
On the other side of the page, on this side of the page, you see at the bottom, on the left hand, on the right hand side. 3 days and three nights.
Then some teachers of the Lord, they said, how evil and godless.
Okay, forget about that. Let's go straight to the
fact. Jesus exclaimed, you asked me for a miracle? No.
For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly, I'm not interested in anything else.
The only miracle you will be given is the miracle of the prophet Jonah. In the same way. That Jonah spent 3 days and three nights, in the same way How did you spend 3 years in Zaire?
That is irrelevant.
Then why?
You are taking English grammar out of context.
Look, I don't know whether you know English, my son.
But I've got A. I'm an A student for English.
No. But you see, your English is perverted.
I'm sorry, I disagree with you. Now you're calling me stupid.
No. Look, you are stupid because it says here, in the same way. What is in the same way? What does it mean? Your language, man. Your language.
You are telling me that I am wrong and telling me that you...
In the same way means in the same way that Jonah was...
In what way was the saying that...
What is the way? It's not that...
3 days and three nights is the only way that what Jesus did...
Right. Okay.
And what happened to Jonah is the same way.
So you say it is the 3 days and three nights.
Okay,
right. Now I'm asking you, go on, when was he crucified? What day?
I think it was a Thursday night or a Friday night.
You will celebrate Good Friday.
You see, the thing is, I'm not Jewish, so I know that Sunday is the first day of the week, the Sabbath
Good
day.
Good Friday is celebrated throughout the Christian world.
Okay.
I'm asking the Christian, what makes Good Friday good?
It was the night that...
So he tells me, because Christ died for our sins on that day.
Okay.
That makes it good. You know, the murder of the only begotten Son, it makes it good because he died for your sins.
Yeah.
So... He was crucified in the afternoon of Good Friday. And towards evening, they got the permission to bring the body down. Nicodemus, he had gone to Pontius Pilate to seek for the body. And he wondered if he were any while dead. He says, no man can die within 3 hours. Because this crucifixion was to be a slow, lingering death.
That's what crucifixion was all about.
Yes. It was not a merciful way out, like shooting a guy, drowning a man, you know, boiling hot water.
Whatever.
That was, the man died too soon.
Yeah.
You see? They wanted a slow, lingering death.
Okay.
That he becomes an object lesson for others.
Yeah.
So look,
well, what's your point?
If you commit the same crime, you'll go that way. So it was supposed to be a slow, lingering death.
Okay.
So Pontius Pilate marvels. He marvels if he were anywhere dead. And the centurion who was standing by, he verified that he is dead.
Mm-hmm. Right. We see that in John chapter 20.
You see, you know the Bible so well.
No, I'm not fantastic. I'm not that learned, believe me.
So, they get the permission to bring the body down. They brought the body down.
Yeah.
They gave him a burial bath, which Jews do. Burial wash.
Yeah.
And they put 100 pound weight of medicines around him. And they put a shroud around him.
Uh-huh.
By that time, it's already evening. You know, you just don't give a bath, putting a bucket of water over the guy. You know, the Jews and the Muslims, with respect, they must have done everything. And 100 pound weight of medicines. You put around.
Sorry, what?
100 pounds weight.
Of what?
Medicines.
What's that?
Ointments.
Perfumes, etc.
Whatever. Right. To put 100 pounds weight.
Yeah. 50 kilograms is a lot.
It's a lot of thing to put around the man. It just kind of... You know, like what you say.
Yeah, it's a time, obviously. But what's your point?
My point is that by the time they finished the job, they put him into the sepulchre. It was already evening.
Okay.
Right. So Friday night, watch my finger.
Yeah.
He's supposed to be in the grave.
Yeah.
Saturday daytime, he's still supposed to be in the grave.
Okay.
Saturday night, he's still supposed to be in the grave.
Yeah.
Sunday morning, the first day of the week.
Uh-huh.
Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb.
Uh-huh.
And the tomb is empty.
Yeah.
So how many days and how many nights?
Oh man, this is irrelevant. You jumped from one... What were we talking about? What was our first point of discussion?
You said 3 days and three nights. You said it's not whether alive or dead.
I'm going to talk to brick walls and get more sense out of them. I'm sure.
Look, same thing to me. I'm a 75-year-old machine.
I respect your age. I respect you.
No, you're not. You're not.
But
you see, you're trying to be funny.
No, I'm not.
Look, I read it as I see it. You said, according to your words, you said it is not three. It is 3 days and three nights. It is not whether dead or alive.
Yeah.
Right. So I agreed with you for a moment. I said, okay, so let us see now whether he fulfilled that. I said, Friday night, he's supposed to be in the grave. He could have come out, but because we have no knowledge, the Bible doesn't say. I won't say. That they just put him there to for sure, and immediately when the people moved away, they took him
and
put him into. I won't say that because it's not written there.
Yeah.
So Friday night he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday day, you see, the day is divided into day parts and night parts. Jesus did that.
Obviously.
For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights. So he divided the day into day part and night part. So I'm doing the same. Friday night, he's supposed to be in the grave.
Yeah.
Saturday day, he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday night, he's still supposed to be in the grave. Sunday morning, the first day of the week, when Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb is empty.
Yeah.
Now, is that 3 days and 3 nights? Look, he said, for as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights, so shall the Son of Man be. Look.
So I'm just going to work out what day it was, because I'm pretty sure.
No, are you understanding English? Simple, basic, 3 days and 3 nights, man. Damn it all, you want to look at a dictionary? You want to look at a concordance for that?
Please don't shout at me.
No. This is my, look, this old machine talks like that. Whether anybody comes along, this is how
I talk.
I don't
like the way you're talking to me, look.
Then you better.
Because
look.
That's not the point I was trying to bring across.
What point you wanted to come out? What point? You tell me that.
No, because what I was trying to say is, in the 3 days and three nights, was, excuse me, that miracle they were asking for, the miracle he was going to show them was the fact that he would be crucified for having claimed to be king of the Jews. He was crucified, buried. The miracle was on the third day he rose. When she went to the tomb, the tomb was empty, the stone had been rolled past, and the tomb was empty, and she was distressed because the body had been removed. And he went behind her, well, he came then, and he says, "Woman, what are you crying about?" And she doesn't realize who he is. That is the miracle.
Where's the miracle?
That he was killed. They had killed him. You see, I'll read it.
No, that's what I'm telling you. Look, that's unlike Jonah. Go on. That is
that's why I'm saying I think you're taking that whole thing out of context.
What? Now don't accuse me for that. You tell me that you are accusing me of taking it out of context.
Look, I think you are.
It is. I am giving you the context as I see it, as I read there. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall, he says, in the same way.
Yeah.
In your Bible says, in the same way.
Yeah.
This one here. This.
Yeah.
In the same way, Good News Bible. It says, in the same way that Jonah was, same way will be with me.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm asking you, Jonah is alive and Jesus is dead.
Okay.
You agreed.
Yeah.
So I said, is this in the same way? It's not in the same way.
That's not what he was trying to
right.
say.
So now you said it was the 3 days and three nights. So I said, okay, in that case, let's see whether he fulfilled that. He was supposed to fulfill the miracle of Jonah. You said, no, it is the time factor. I said, okay, let's look at the time factor.
I don't know the Jewish calendar, please. I can't argue.
Let me tell you, look, man, you don't want to know the Jewish calendar or the Gregorian or the Arab.
I don't know that Friday was the night he was crucified. They do not say Friday here. I don't know these things. I can't say you're wrong.
For 2,000 years, the Christian world is commemorating Good Friday. Am I right?
Yeah.
Are they all led by the devil for 2,000 years? That means, damn it all, you didn't know when he was crucified. For 2,000 years,
yes.
You are commemorating Good Friday. I asked you, what makes Good Friday good? You said Christ died for your sins.
Why have we called it Good Friday?
Good. What makes it good?
No, why have we called it Good Friday, is what I'm saying, Friday, out of tradition? Tradition that has been introduced. That is my point.
No, who introduced the tradition? The devil or Jesus Christ? Who introduced that tradition? The devil introduced that tradition into you for 2,000 years and still you don't know.
It was 2,000 years. It was probably less than 1,000 years.
Okay, 1,000 years.
Yeah.
You are still in the 20th century, my son.
Yeah.
Mighty America is commemorating Good Friday. And South Africa, the whites and the blacks, they're all commemorating Good Friday.
So,
and every Christian nation on earth, including France, Germany,
whatever,
and in Russia, and in Greece, and every damn country in the world, they all commemorate Good Friday.
Yes.
And I'm asking, what makes Good Friday good? And they all tell me, unanimous, that because Christ died for our sins on that day.
Yeah.
Right. So I said, it was a Good Friday. He said, yes, that it was in the afternoon. It was not 9 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
This is no. It was in the afternoon.
Yeah.
So I said, now all this burial wash and the ointments and the shroud and putting the man into the sepulchre, you know, it takes time. So it's already evening. You agreed with me. So I said, so in that case, Friday evening, Friday night, he's supposed to be in the grave.
I just interject here. This is where I have contention, is that I agree with you. We call it Good Friday. You have counted Friday, Saturday night being only 1.5 days.
Agreed? 2 nights and a day.
1.5 days.
No, 2 nights and a day.
Night being only 1.5 days.
Agreed? 2 nights and a day.
1.5 days.
No, 2 nights and a day.
Which is 12 hours. Call it 1.5 days.
Night time.
I'm just compounding what you see what I'm saying.
Don't do that. Look.
Okay, 2 nights and 1 day.
2 nights and a day.
Okay, great.
But he said 3 nights and 3 days.
No, I'm getting to that. Please, I hear what you're saying and I agree with you. But my point is, tradition has now dictated that that Friday, whether it's a Thursday or a Wednesday, you'll agree now, when is good, that time that Jesus Christ was crucified? In fact, it's actually the celebration, the Jewish celebration is for when he's crucified, to when he ascended, to Ascension Day, is the Jewish celebration over that period of time. But that time that he was crucified, we call it Good Friday. I don't know why, because a lot of times in my life, Good Friday has probably more than not appeared on a Wednesday or a Thursday. In fact, this year it was on a Thursday.
No, no. Good Friday appears on Good Friday. It's Good Friday is always,
what I'm trying to say is,
and Easter Monday is a Monday. Every year of the year, is the dates are changing, but the day, the dates, you know, dates, you know, the 16th or 17th or 18th, now the dates change, but the days remain. Friday is Friday. We have 4 days holiday in South Africa. Do you know that?
Yeah.
In America, 4 days holiday. In Britain, 4 days holiday during this Easter season.
Yeah.
Right. So why Friday? Because Christ died on Good Friday.
What 4 days are those?
Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday.
So do you not think that maybe he rose again on Monday and not on the Sunday, making it 3 days and 3 nights?
Maybe. This is how you celebrate Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Four days.
4 days. Why is public? Why is Monday the public holiday as well? If it's only 3 days.
Because man, you know, Sunday is a holiday in any case. Sunday is a holiday. That is now not because of Jesus Christ being resurrected on that day. That's not the reason. You have the worship of the sun god, your pagan ancestors. They worship the sun god on a Sunday.
Nonsense, man. Slow it down. Sunday is the first day of the week. That is the Sabbath.
That is the Jewish calculation.
The Sabbath day in actual fact is a Saturday, not a Sunday.
No. The Jewish calculation. Sunday is the first day of the week.
Okay.
Saturday means seventh.
Which is the Sabbath day.
Sabbath day. Now, the Christian, not the Christian, well, the pagan world, Greece, Rome, they all had the worship of the sun god. They were worshipping the sun god on a Sunday. They were not worshipping the sun god because of Jesus Christ rose on that day. They were worshipping the sun god on a Sunday. That's why you call it Sunday. Sunday is the worship of the sun on that day.
Oh, I don't know that, but yes, I'll take your word for it. Seems pretty logical.
Monday is the worship of Mon, stars. These are all the gods of your ancient pagan forefathers. You know, the Norwegians and the Danes.
Whatever.
They worshipped all these things, and they commemorated Sunday as the worship of the sun god.
Yeah.
Right. So now you are having a public holiday in any case.
Yeah.
Whenever in South Africa we have a holiday falling on Sunday, we have automatically a holiday on Monday.
Yeah, I agree with you. I understand what you're saying there.
Right. So, now, for that reason, not that because Christ could have been resurrected on Monday.
Yeah.
No. This is the logic for why Monday is always a holiday.
Yeah.
Because of Sunday.
Because of Sunday. So they'd pass it through to Monday.
Right.
So because Saturday is the Sabbath day, do you not think that Jesus Christ might not, if he was, we'll presume, because the Bible says, just theoretically speaking, hypothetical, that because he was crucified and was dead for 3 days and 3 nights, ignoring whether Jonah was alive or dead in the well, the fact was the comparison in Jonah's miracle, which is what I was trying to say, in Jonah's miracle and Jesus, the miracle that Jesus, or the sign that Jesus was going to give, was the fact that he would be dead for 3 days and 3 nights. He would be in the earth. That's what he said, right? You'll agree.
But there's nothing miraculous about that.
No, just hold on, slow down. You'll agree with me that he said he would be in the earth for 3 days and
he
three
didn't
nights.
Say that. He'll say like Jonah.
Okay, forget about like
how Jonah. You can't, man. Damn it all. This man is emphasizing.
Glasses?
Yeah.
Just hold your glasses.
Yeah, read it.
So will the Son of Man spend 3 days and nights in the depths of the earth.
Right.
You'll agree with me.
So. When it says so. So will the Son. Right.
No, you're taking out, you're not listening to my point. Can I please finish what I'm saying?
Yes, my son.
You keep jumping down my throat, and I don't get a chance to repeat myself. My son, look.
You see, you are terrified of truth.
No. What does it say here? The truth shall set you free. I've been set free by the word of God.
Let's change the subject for a little while.
I want to finish the point. I was
useless because it's you are so worked up, you are so closed in, just like the Jews.
I think that's a very unfair thing to say.
No, look, Jesus Christ showed many miracles, but the Jews couldn't see them. Jesus is seeing, they see not. Jesus said, seeing they see not, hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. It can happen. It can happen to the most intellectual of people, the Jews. It can happen to them. It can happen to you and to me. Right? That you don't want to see the truth. Man, simple, basic things. I'm giving you, a little child can follow this. I says Friday night, Saturday day, Saturday night. Sunday morning, first day of the week, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb and the tomb is empty. You agree. So I said 2 nights and a day. Jesus said 3 days and 3 nights.
Man, he repeats it. Just taking it right out of context, completely and utterly. What day is the Sabbath day in the Jewish calendar?
Saturday.
Okay, great. He arose on the Sabbath, did he not?
I don't know. When he arose, you're telling me Sunday morning he wasn't there.
No.
First day of the week.
I'm saying Sunday morning because that is the calendar I live to now. But in the Roman calendar.
No. There in your Bible it says Sunday, he says there, in the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene goes. What is first day of the week?
Sunday.
Right. So now, there it is. Look, Friday night, Saturday day, Saturday night.
Everything on Friday night, because we now, in 20th day modern world, call Good Friday the day he was crucified. But we are not basing that on fact. It is tradition that we call it Good Friday.
So this tradition came in from the devil. Is the devil misled you for 2,000 years? Because for 2,000 years the Christian world is commemorating.
So what if
Friday?
They celebrate it on a Tuesday, on a Wednesday night? Whatever. Mm-hmm. The fact is that Jesus Christ was crucified.
Such an elementary thing. The man was crucified on Friday, or you say no, it was Wednesday.
And he rose on Monday morning. If it had been three nights, which should be right. If you're talking now as the first day of the week, what is the first day of the week in today's modern society? What is the first day of the week?
Monday.
So he rose on a Monday. If we want to count today, Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night. Saturday, Sunday, Monday.
Right.
He rose on Monday.
Right.
3 days, three nights.
Now this John, that fellow of yours, John, he didn't know that Monday was to be the first day of the week. He didn't know. He only knew he's a Jew.
Because time has changed since then. It's 2,000 years ago.
The man who wrote that, he is writing for his people.
No, Matthew wrote this.
All right. Also John. You see, also Luke wrote about the crucifixion.
Yeah.
So when Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb, he says it was the first day of the week. It was not Monday in his mind.
It was Sunday.
So Friday night.
No, but Sunday. Then it wasn't Friday. That's my point. You understand?
Tell me where to start. You tell me now.
Okay,
come on.
Okay, well, the thing is, what I'm trying to compare is... Then,
Sabbath day
was a Saturday.
Give me any day. Come on, you tell me where to start. I want this 3 days and three nights. The man said...
I'm saying it was a Thursday night, not a Friday night.
Right. Let's say now. What? Friday? Thursday night.
Yeah.
Thursday night he's put into the tomb. Right. So Thursday night he's supposed to be in the tomb.
Yeah.
Friday day. Thursday night.
Just slow down. I'm just going to write this.
Thursday night.
Okay, I'm going to split it in half so it's day and night.
Right.
Okay, Thursday night. Thursday night.
Okay, right. Now let's
okay.
come. Let's come. Simple arithmetic.
Mm-hmm. Thursday night.
Right. Thursday night. Got
okay.
it one?
Right. Okay, Friday.
Friday day. Look. Friday day.
Yes.
Friday night.
Yes.
Saturday day.
Yeah.
Saturday night.
Okay.
Sunday morning, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb is empty.
Yeah.
It's still 3 and 2.
No, you got a Sunday now. Now we are Sunday. You see what I'm saying? That's my point.
No, no, he's not there. Damn it all, he's not there Sunday morning.
He'd risen on the third day. That morning he had risen.
He didn't say on the third day. He said, for as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights,
he arose on the Sunday.
So shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights.
Yeah.
Did he mean what he said? 3 days and 3 nights means full 72 hours.
Yeah. No, that's so technical, man. That is so relevant.
But this man is going out of his way to emphasize the thing, man. Damn it all, what is he wasting time? Three. Why does he bore everybody to death? In every
Roman,
in every damn language, says once was Jonah, drie da and drie nachte, in the beek van de groot vis was, so shall the sien van die mens, drie da and drie nachte, damn it all, in Zulu, se tvoguba chengo chona, vise sisu, in sen hom, izin sugu, izin tatu, nobu sugu, ubu tatu, ken chalo oge, non tata, yo mundu, uya guba, sebu tunji, ni bom saba, izin sugu, damn it all, is repeating the word three, boring 4 times, damn it all. Yeah. He could have said 3 days. He could have said on the third day. He's going out of his way to tell you exactly like this. What happened to Jonah is going to happen to me.
And the fact that he would be gone for 3 years and 3 nights. Now,
not gone, he'll be alive and you expect him to be dead.
No, who said he had to be alive?
He said, this miracle of Jonah is that he's alive.
Okay, look, I just want to make something clear. When you said, okay, I'll agree with you. In the same way that Jonah spent 3 days and 3 nights with the big fish.
That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Okay, the point he is making is in the same way that Jonah spent 3 days and 3 nights, whether Jonah was alive, how many miracles happened.
In the same way.
No, you're going into details in that scripture and taking it out of context.
Jesus is going into details, three. Man, why does he want to go into details? He could have said on the third day.
Oh, he could have, I suppose you can interpret it that way.
Why the hell he repeats the word 3-4 times? He's repeating the word 3-4 times.
Because he was saying, as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights, so he will be 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the earth.
Exactly. So you see, the man had himself prophesied,
okay.
Jesus, and he didn't fulfill it. As far as the time factor is concerned, he failed. As far as the miracles aspect is failed. You see, the disciples of Jesus, they had heard from hearsay, people talking. That the master was hanged on the cross. They had heard from hearsay, people talking, that he had given up the ghost, his spirit had come out, he had died. They had heard from hearsay, people talking, that now he's dead and buried for 3 days. A man with such a reputation, we expect him to be stinking in his grave, because Mark chapter 14 verse 50, he tells us that at the most critical juncture in the life of Jesus, all his disciples forsook him and fled. All!
So I'm just going to read that quickly, just to remind myself.
Yeah, please.
Sorry, 14,
13. Mark chapter 14, verse 50. Mark 14,
50. The thing is, I do know scripture reasonably well, but I can't just pull it out of my head.
That's all right. Yes, please read it aloud. I might have misquoted you.
Mark 14:13.
50.
Right. Then he will show you a large upstairs room fixed up and furnished where you will get everything ready for us.
For all his disciples forsook him and fled.
Mark. Jesus eats the Passover meal with his disciples.
Mark. Mark 14, 50. Come on, man. I don't know what's wrong with you. Huh? Why, man? Young man, you need spectacles.
Mark 14.
50. Yes, I keep on telling you 50. You said 13. I said 14, 50.
Apologies. I thought you said 15. I didn't realize it's 50. Okay, my apologies. I'll get it now.
Then they all forsook him and fled.
No, I left him and ran away. Could you give me, okay.
All I want to know.
Why do you think, Okay, I'm going to read from verse 43, and that whole, okay.
Right.
I'm going to read it from the top, because it says, okay. The arrest of Jesus.
And immediately, while?
Jesus was still speaking when Judas, one of the 12 disciples,
Where are you now?
Verse 43.
Verse 43, and immediately while he was still speaking to Judas, right?
With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, and, because we know that Judas was the one that betrayed Jesus, right?
Right.
With swords and clubs, and sent by the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. The traitor had given the crowd a signal. The man I kiss is the one you want. Arrest him and take him away under guard.
Little slow. Read a little.
As soon as Judas arrived, he went up to Jesus and said, "Teacher," and kissed him. So they arrested Jesus and held him tight. But one of those standing there drew his sword and struck at the high priest's slave, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus spoke up and said to them, "Did you have to come with swords and clubs to capture me as though I were an outlaw? Day after day I was with you, teaching in the temple, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must come true." And then, as you said, then all the disciples left him and ran away.
Imagine this scenario.
You are with three of your friends down here at the corner of the temple. You're standing on the corner of what's this, Queen Street and Grey Street. You're standing there. Now one of the friends, you don't realize it, but one of those friends has committed a heinous crime. He killed a family in Phoenix Park. He was driving out there for business, and something happened and drove him to it. He took out a gun and shot a family of five. The police came, and a man said, "That's him there." And that friend was standing next to you, passively shaking your hand, or he was just talking to you. The police run up, grab this man. They grab him, not just, excuse me, search, I mean, they grab him, physically take hold of him, put handcuffs on him, throw him against the wall, put the handcuffs on him, and drag away, throw him in the police van, and run away. Do they drive away? Would you not want to run away? Would you not be terrified for your life?
Of course.
Now, do you not think there is the possibility that the disciples ran away out of fear for their lives?
Of course.
So then what is wrong with that?
Look, what I'm trying to tell you is, you are only confirming what I'm telling you, my son. I'm telling you that, you see, when they arrested Jesus,
okay,
you know, the game was up. They were preparing for a showdown with the Jews. Jesus Christ told them at that upper room, at the Last Supper, that those of you, you know, who's got no swords, you must sell your garments and buy them.
Where does he say this?
Man, look, man, you can't be that green. No, I said in the Last Supper, you know the Bible so well, and now you're speaking like an ignoramus. Look, you're trying to make things difficult for me.
No,
I'm telling you that at the Last Supper, if you remember reading your scripture, Jesus is asking his disciples that when I sent you out on your mission of preaching and healing,
Mark 16,
and I told you that you must not carry anything extra with you, no purse, no script, no staff, nothing.
Yeah.
Did you lack anything? They said, "No, we lack nothing." But now I tell you, those of you who have no swords, you must sell your garments and buy them.
This is Mark 16 you're talking about.
I don't know the reference. You know your Bible.
If you ought to know.
Okay. You ought to know your Bible, whether I'm quoting correctly or not.
Okay. Oh, sorry, I've gone a bit far. Matthew, Mark, sorry. Okay, 15.
Amazing, man. Such a simple scene. You know, the scene,
I don't know scripture that well.
But if you read that once in your life, damn it all, you can never erase it from your mind. The scene is there. All are sitting at the table. And Jesus starts. He said, "Look, this is what happened. I sent you out. And did you lack anything?" He says, "No. But now I tell you, those of you who's got no swords, you must sell your garments and buy them." And one of them said, "Master, we have two already." You haven't come across that yet?
It's here, Matthew 9. I know the scripture
read it loud. Read it loud. I want to hear.
I'm going to read to see where you look with the part. Like, I'm straight from verse 5. These 12, I'm going to read from the beginning of chapter 10 rather. Jesus called his 12 disciples together and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon.
No, we don't. What, you're wasting time. Come to the point, man, about those swords. Okay. The swords.
I don't know if I'm in the right place for a start. Please,
then,
I don't know scripture that well. I'm only 21. And when I get to your age, I'll probably be as knowledgeable on the Bible as you.
You'll be losing your memory then.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. go and preach the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, bring the dead back to life, heal those who suffer from dreaded skin diseases, and drive out demons. You have received without paying, so give without being paid. Do not carry any gold, silver, or copper money in your pockets. Do not carry a beggar's bag for the trip, or an extra shirt or shoes or a walking stick. A worker should be given what he needs. When you come to a town or village, go in and look for someone who is willing to welcome you. No, there's nothing about swords or anything here.
And behold, handmaid betrays, right? Didn't I fix that on you?
Nothing there about swords.
But you don't remember the sword. Now I'll have to find it for you.
Please do, because that you say you've misquoted a scripture there, as far as I know. Well, I've just read the part you're telling me.
I didn't give you that reference. You found it yourself. Yeah, did I tell you to open Mark? Did I tell you open Mark?
No, that's Daniel. No, sorry, no. This is Matthew, not Mark.
Right. Did
Mark,
I tell you open? Did I tell you open Matthew? Mark. Did I tell you? I only gave you the incident. That
yeah,
this
and
is
I went to the only one I know of that in the Bible.
There are four places, man. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all speak about the Last Supper.
Okay,
and I'm talking about the Last Supper. Right, here.
Okay.
Yeah. But now, he who has a money bag, let him take it, and likewise a sack. And he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you, that this which is written must still be accomplished on me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. Then they said, Lord, look, here are two swords. And he said to them, it is enough. Am I quoting correctly now?
I'm just sorry, where are you? I'm going to read this for myself. I'm not denying what, I'm not disbelieving.
It's Luke
12,
chapter 22. Chapter 22,
okay.
Verse 38. Read it loud, please.
Okay. Well, then Jesus asked his disciples, when I sent you out that time without purse, bag, or shoes, did you lack anything? Not a thing, they answered. But now, Jesus said, whoever has a purse or a bag must take it, and whoever does not have a sword must sell his coat and buy one. For I tell you that the scripture says, he shared the fate of criminals must come true about me, because of what is written about me is coming true. The disciples said, look, here are two swords, Lord. That is enough, he replied.
Right, right. So now Jesus is telling his disciples that they must arm themselves.
Okay. So what is
now, in other words, he is going to resist. Because what do you use swords for, my son, except to fight? You don't use swords for paring bananas and apples.
Okay.
No. Swords.
I'm listening to you.
When you talk about swords, what is the purpose of a sword? You remember one of the disciples, he slashed off one guy's ear with a sword.
One of the disciples.
You read it just now a little while back. Yeah,
as soon as Judas arrived, he went up to Jesus and said, teacher, and kissed him. So they arrested Jesus and held him tight. But one of those standing there drew his sword and struck the high priest. Who's standing where? Yes. How many people were in that temple at that time? And how many
not
of them
temple,
were
this is in the Garden of Gethsemane, my son. What's wrong with you, man? I can't understand, man. What you have been reading the Bible for 21 years?
I'm going to read it again. Jesus was still speaking when Jesus... Okay, he was in the Garden of Gethsemane.
Right. No, you're talking about the temple now. You said no, temple.
Sorry.
I said it's the Garden of Gethsemane.
I apologize. The Garden of Gethsemane, you are correct. Jesus was still speaking when Judas, one of the 12 disciples, the one who was to betray him, arrived. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs and sent by the chief priests,
right,
the teachers of the law and the elders.
Right.
The traitor had given the crowd a signal, Judas that is, the man I kiss is the one you want, arrest him and take him away under guard. As soon as Judas arrived, he went up to Jesus and said, teacher, and kissed him. So they arrested Jesus and held him. But one of those standing there drew his sword and struck at the high priest's slave. The high priest slave, you'll agree, was probably one of those men with swords and clubs, right?
Right.
Okay.
But now the one who struck him was a disciple of Jesus.
With him was a crowd armed with... I'm just going to...
The guy who struck the high priest's servant...
He was a disciple?
Then who was he? Because if
there was a crowd there that Jesus was talking to. He wasn't talking to the disciples only. It's got there in verse...
I can't imagine such perversion in your reading. Such perversion, I can't imagine. A Welsh guy, you know. I don't know, man. But let me tell you.
So what if I'm Welsh?
No.
If I was Greek, it wouldn't make a difference, would it?
It would.
Wow.
You see, look, you would understand the thing better. You'll have more humility. Let me tell you, reading there, that the people had come with clubs and swords.
Yeah.
Right. Then who struck that guy with the sword?
says one of those standing there.
Right. Who was that? How many people were standing with Jesus? In the Garden of Gethsemane. There were 11 guys there, man.
Yeah, excluding Judas. Okay.
11 guys
but
were there.
What I'm
so
saying
now,
is
they were armed at the upper room. You said the master, there were two already.
Yeah.
Right? What did they do with the sword? They left them behind? Or they took them with?
That was up in the room. Who said they took? The thing is, okay, I'm not disagreeing with you. My point is, a lot of the things you discuss here are quite irrelevant. The details that...
To me, each and everything is relevant. You see, if it's in the book of God, and if Jesus Christ took the trouble of having his word recorded in red, you got this word recorded in red, that means, damn it all, they're wasting their time, man, all this doom and exercise. Mm-hmm. What for? So, everything is relevant. The thing is, it doesn't suit you, that's different. In the upper room, Jesus is asking the disciples that when I sent you out on your mission of preaching and healing, at that time I told you not to carry anything with you. Did you lack anything? They says, no, we lack nothing. But now I tell you that those of you who's got no swords must sell your garments and buy them. So far, so good? So then one of them said, Master, we have two already. So Jesus said, that is enough. Now they said, let's go. Get out from this place, because they were like sitting ducks in that upper room. If the Jews were planning his destruction, he would be sitting there all cooped up in a room. Let's get out of this place. So they walked to Gethsemane, 5 miles out of town. They're going to Gethsemane not to pray, because if they wanted to pray, they could have prayed in that upper room. If they wanted to pray, they would have gone to the temple of Jerusalem. The stones throw away. Yeah. They wouldn't have to walk 5 miles out of town.
Mm-hmm.
When they reach Gethsemane, he tells 8 of his disciples, he says, tarry here and watch with me, while I go and pray yonder.
Now when he gets back, they're all asleep.
But he takes with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee.
Yeah.
First he makes a one defense at the gate, 8 of his devoted disciples, people who are beating their breasts. That, Master, we are prepared to die for you. Master, we are prepared to go to prison for you.
Okay.
Right. Now comes a crunch. He said, now you sit and watch. Keep guard. Watch means not the moon and the stars. Keep guard. Watch means keep guard. So 8 at the gate. And he says, I will go and pray yonder. I. Alone. But he takes with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee. And he says, sit ye here and watch with me. He makes another line of defense. First, 8 at the gate. Another line of defense, and then he goes further into the garden and he falls on his face and he prays to God. He said, oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass away from me. Meaning, remove the difficulty from me. But not as I will, but as thou wilt.
The fact that he would have to die and go through the pain and suffering.
If that is what you want, my Lord, I am prepared to submit. But I want you to save me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed to God. Oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup, means this difficulty, pass away from me. But if it is your will, I am prepared to submit.
Mm-hmm.
After beseeching God for help, now look, it appears that he didn't know that he was supposed to die. Because if he was supposed to die, he should have handed himself over to the Jews and says, come on, man, you know, I have come for this purpose. Go on, do what you want. But no, he takes his men outside that room. He goes and makes an outer line of defense, 8 at the gate. If you have served in the army at all, you know those 2 years,
yes,
conscription. You would know, man, when your commander, your corporal says, hey, you said, yeah, right. You say, follow me. You know what game that you are playing. You know what is involved. You have that sense.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you wouldn't be such a loony to have you there in the army. You know, they pass you through that you are a sane fellow and you know what they tell you, 2 + 2 makes 4. Now, he puts 8 at the gate, keep guard, and he's telling them, watch with me, means keep guard, not pray with me. And he goes a little, goes further in, and he makes another inner line of defense.
Yeah.
And out of those 3, at least 2 were armed with swords.
He says it was those 2, he says it wasn't 2 of the 8.
They said they had 2 already.
Yeah, they had 2 swords, okay.
Right, so 8 at the gate, with sticks and stones, they're keeping guard that the
Jews... Where does it say they have sticks and stones?
He's telling...
Man, this is totally arbitrary and irrelevant.
He's telling them, you carry everything with you. Now you carry everything with you. when I told you before to go out on a mission of preaching and healing, I told you not to carry anything. But now I tell you, you must carry your shoes, spare shoes, and your staff, and everything that you got to carry with
and
you.
And your spouse was because he feared for their lives, because, or for because them having been associated with him.
Because the things concerning me have an end, and now he's making a march to Gethsemane. At Gethsemane, he puts 8 at the gate. To do what? To do what? Why did he take them to the garden? I want to know from you now.
Maybe he wanted to be on his own in the garden.
Damn it all, then why didn't he go on his own? Why does he have to drag 11 more people with him?
Why
would you want to drag, if you want to go to the garden to go and pray, damn it all, couldn't you pray in that upper room? Is your God far away from that upper room? Is he far away from the temple? Why does he have to go to Gethsemane?
Did he have to have a reason to go to Gethsemane?
Why does he do full silly thing in the middle of the night? Damn it, 11 guys, you're dragging 11 guys along. You must be a loony, man.
Who says?
You must be a loony, dragging...
Who says they didn't go with him out of free will? Who says, my Lord, where are you going? He said, I'm going to pray. Who says they didn't go with him? And who says that because they were with
him... Damn it all, read that book, man. Read that book. You haven't read the book. You didn't even know this verse I'm talking about.
I did. I knew.
What you knew?
I didn't know where it was. I had to look for it.
But didn't you know the sense of what I was telling you?
No, because you take it out of context.
A little child can understand, can remember.
I really hope that if I'm right, I really hope that God has mercy on you.
You see, you are so damn presumptuous, I'm telling you. You are sick, my son.
I'm not sick.
You are really sick. I can tell you. Look, you are really sick.
How am I sick?
You see, what you have got, I must congratulate you.
I must congratulate you
that you are a master at in mental masturbation.
This
what you're doing now is mental masturbation. You are masturbating mentally. Everything, man, damn it all, you can't see this. You want me to open this for you? I have to find verses for you. And you are supposed to know your Bible.
When you can talk... I'm 21.
Damn it all.
I'm not...
See, uncle, I think this young man, I admire his...
His mental masturbation.
His dogged determination.
Right.
He didn't make the claim he knows everything of the Bible.
Right.
And I admire him for wanting to try.
Right.
And I think that it's admirable that he's willing to try.
Right.
He'll have to change his approach a little bit, not only in discussion with you, like he'll have to learn some of the things and make a note.
Right.
But I'm curious to find out which church he belongs to.
I'm at Victory Faith Center in Pinetown.
What's that?
And who's the...
What's that? No, I didn't hear that.
Victory Faith Center.
Victory Faith Center.
Just around the corner from San Lim Center.
Victory
and
Faith
who's
Center.
Who's the
pastor? Sean Dooley.
Are you taking lessons from him?
No. And this is why I'm saying, I totally admire you. You're 75 and, man, you know the Bible better than I do. That is disgusting for me, man. For a Christian, I've been a Christian since I was standard six.
But you see, look, you're the pastor. He doesn't know the Bible better than me. Your Pope doesn't know the Bible better than me. It's a shame on you all, damn it all. Listen, I'm telling you, there isn't a Christian born.
But uncle, this is what I'm getting at.
Yes.
Why don't we ask the young man to invite his
wife? Right, bring that guy along and you sit and watch and listen.
Yes. Because this is discussion
this
is good. I mean, it doesn't mean you're converting your religion. No, nobody's asking you.
No, this but is not going to
bring that pastor. Bring your pastor. And what, my son, God, what you do, you just sit relaxed. Then you watch. You see, you'll be able to see things more objectively.
Yeah.
Then I've been asked talking. These questions and I didn't know that, but why don't you come along? You know,
surely he knows his Bible.
He
won't be belaboring me, trying to, look, at this age, I have to look, find verses for you. It's not fair. It's not fair to me.
I apologize for that.
You see? So I said, look, then, in other words, everything now is mental masturbation that you're doing.
And
I said,
invite his pastor.
Mm. Please. Can you do that?
I'll speak to him. I don't know how willing he'd be.
If he's not willing, there's something wrong with him and with your church.
See, what I'm going to say is the reason I came was not, I had no intention of trying to convert anybody
to find knowledge to share.
I mean, I see Muslims, as a salesman, I see Muslims in the street nearly every day. And a lot of them, they sit there and I walk into a shop and I'm really friendly, I'm enthusiastic, I have no intention of trying to force them to sell whatever I'm selling, but a lot of them sit there and they go, and they won't even talk to me. I learn the language, I say, Salaam alaikum, you know, to be polite and respectful.
Beautiful.
And they just, I feel very offended that they won't even say good morning, like, you know, thank you, but we're not really interested. They just, like, mannequins. And I came here in the interest of finding out, you know, why? It's just, you know, is it something in their belief that they refuse to, or they do not wish to speak.
No, there are many things. I mean, you see, it's you have people and you have people.
Yeah.
There are many Christians, for example, that feel sorry for me. When they see us, they genuinely feel sorry. They're not bad people.
Yeah,
they feel sorry that I'm going to go to hell because I've not accepted Jesus.
Yeah.
Then there is the political angle, you know, that you are white, they are black.
Yeah.
You know, they see you, they say, now what does this white man want? You know,
yeah.
I'm not saying that everybody, you know, people have different levels of tolerance. They are suspicious. Is this guy an inspector from some department?
Right.
In the past, all the inspectors have been white. You know, is he some inspector of some department that has come
in? I agree. The social reasons.
That's right. We have been kept apart. But the one way of growing closer together, it doesn't mean conversion. It doesn't mean everybody's got to convert. It's for us to talk.
Which is what I came to do.
Which is what you think. I admire you. I started off by saying I respect you and admire you for that. But as a young man, what is happening? You are taking up Mr. Dida's time unintentionally by asking him to look up verses.
Yes, I apologize for that.
So what you can do, I'm sure you have made notes and you've got a lot of food for thought as well.
Yes.
To speak to your pastor, to say, look, and you're entitled to, just as I am entitled to speak to my priest, to say, look, this young man, Sean, asked me certain questions about Islam, and I'm not ashamed of it, but I'm not qualified enough to answer. Would you come along? Because he's willing to ask you those questions. So likewise, we would be more than delighted to invite the gentleman to extend an invitation.
I'll speak to him.
To him alone, or if he was to come with several people, we don't...
Or I'll come to your church. Or I can come to your church.
He's too busy. Yeah. Mr. Dida will come
I can meet you in Pansan, and we can meet at the church.
At the church. I'll talk to the whole congregation.
Yeah, because you see, the thing is, I get very, like, if you three gentlemen sit in front of me now, I'm, you know, as a person, it's not, you know, I don't know if everybody's like this, I feel very, like, you know, I start to break out in a sweat and I stutter and stammer, because that's why I wanted to either speak to your son or yourself individually, you know, one on one, because then, you know, I get three people shouting things at me and I'm talking and I'm getting very, like, I start shaking. But one on one, I feel I can communicate, and my intention is not in any way to be, you know, aggressive, that we can communicate, because I realize that probably very little I say is going to convince you that I'm right, and
I can do to convince you.
Because, you know, like I said to your son yesterday, if you're a drunkard, an Arabian person, you're in a gutter somewhere, and you came to the point where you felt you had to turn to God, you wouldn't walk all the way downtown the street to a European church, you'd go to a mosque.
True.
And if I was in the same position, I wouldn't walk all the way down the street to a mosque. So that is the social difference.
But those barriers are harder to overcome than legal barriers.
You know, social barriers are bigger than life.
They are being overcome. I mean,
five
years
ago, I wouldn't have come in here if I'd been a racist at all.
Exactly.
I wonder, 5 years I'm not a racist, ago, but I love everyone. I've nothing against anyone.
Take from a political point of view, you know, 5 years ago or 4 years ago.
I had the office here 5 years ago.
Oh, yes, we did. But you'd be arrested for having a flag, a communist flag. You'd be arrested by that.
Oh, yeah, okay, I see.
But now today, now 5 years ago, if you told somebody, no, we can talk to everybody, said, no. But now we've just bought a ship from Russia. The South African Navy has bought a ship, and then the Russian sailors and captain were there to hand over the ship. They were shaking hands. And
etc.
So times change.
Political differences have been solved.
But 5 years ago, as you said, no ways the person would have even turned to Russia to have a look at. Because they worked out it's about a third cheaper than to build a ship today.
Right.
To buy this big ship, and this is going to be able to, I think it can even break ice or whatever. Big
icebreakers.
But you know, I saw there all the Russian people handing over Russian dog, the mascot is going to remain with the ship. But this is unheard of. 5 years ago, we wouldn't even, you would arrest the guy if he had that flag.
Communist emblem.
We don't support communism. I'll just give you an example.
I agree with the example.
So likewise, I'm not saying we're here to convert each other, but we haven't sat and spoken to each other for centuries.
Yeah, I want to come and sit down and be friendly. I want to leave here with a smile on my face.
We are friends. Yeah, we are friends. Well, this is discussion is healthy. Mm, to argue and raise voice.
I've learned so much from you.
What you should do is we should pursue this further. Yes. Otherwise, it's a waste of the exercise.
Completely.
Otherwise, say, well, it's futile. A nice feeling.
Yeah.
So invite over your priest or anybody from the congregation if the priest doesn't want to come. But it leaves a question mark in your mind that why he's not willing to come.
Well, the thing is, I'm not going to make excuses for him. If he's a busy man and he says, no, I'm going to go sit with him and pose questions and then come back to you. So this is what he told me.
That's why we are leaving the invitation open. We're not saying next Tuesday or Wednesday. If he's a busy man, he can open his diary and
say, is this your business card? Could I grab it?
Yes. He can open his diary and say, look, the earliest I can fit you in is November.
Right.
And at 9 o'clock at night because I'm busy in the day.
Yeah. Right.
Fine, we'll come.
I said, come to my church. I said, right.
Great.
Now look,
gone.
Now, there is one little problem I have in the Bible. I want you to, maybe you might throw some light on it. Yes.
Okay, great.
The analogy is that your father and your mother, let's say they are alive, and they're sleeping. They're sleeping. In the middle of the night, a burglar gets in.
Yeah.
And your dad grapples with the burglar, but the burglar is too powerful.
Yeah.
He floors your dad, he sits on his chest and is strangling him to death.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother comes to the rescue. And she saves his life.
Kills them.
Saves their father's life.
Okay.
Now your dad says, go on, chop off your mother's hands. Chop off her hands. He said, Daddy, are you joking? He said, no, my son, I'm serious. He says, Daddy, have you been taking some drugs or alcohol? Have you been drinking?
Mm.
He says, no, my son, this is from the book of God. The Holy Bible, the Bible, the good God tells us that we must chop off your mother's hand. So, Daddy, no God can give you such a thing. You know, this woman, your mother, she gave you so many children. You know, you tell. And she gave you pleasure, endless pleasure for 40 years.
Mm.
And now she saved your life. A Hindu would be prepared to worship her. This such a mother, such a woman, he will be prepared to worship her. And we can understand his sentiments, you know. He said, the woman saved my life, she's a goddess. She's my God. We can understand, appreciate his feelings. You, Dad, you telling me to chop off her hands, you know, this is lunacy of the highest order. You agree?
Yes.
If you said God says so, then you would also say that, look, this God also is a loony. If a God gives you such instructions for saving a person's life, you chop off her hands, I said, that God is also loony. Daddy? He says, my son, open the book. Deuteronomy! Open. Deuteronomy chapter 25. This is the instruction from God. Deuteronomy chapter 25. Deuteronomy chapter 25. Got it? Chapter 25?
Yeah.
Right? Verse 11 and 12. Read it aloud.
If two men are having a fight, and the wife of one tries to help her husband by grabbing hold of the other man's genitals, show her no mercy, cut off her hand.
Show her no mercy, cut off her hands. This woman, she saved your father's life.
Okay.
Chop off her hands. Is that sanity or lunacy?
That's the law from the Old Testament.
Whatever. Is that the law of God?
Of the Old Testament.
Did God give such a law?
Yes, he laid it down for the Jews and for the Jewish nation at that time.
Right. Jesus says, think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. You know, the word law in Hebrew is Torah.
Yeah.
Right. The law or the prophets. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm come not to destroy but to fulfill.
Mm-hmm.
For verily I say unto you, heaven and earth shall pass away, but one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Yes.
Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, or shall teach men so, shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall teach and do shall be called great.
Okay.
Right. This is the law which he confirmed. Don't think that I'm come to break the laws and the commandments.
Yeah.
Not the least bit out of the law is to go out. And this is supposed to be the word of God, inspired to Moses.
Yeah.
Right? So, did God inspire such nonsense that the woman who saved your father's life was chopped off her hands?
The way I see it, is that in the Old Testament, God, because, okay, you'll understand that God is a spirit being. You agree?
Yes, yes.
He is perfect in every way.
He is perfect in everything.
So therefore, because of that perfection, God cannot allow imperfection in his presence.
Right.
So he could not come down to the people and rule them. So he had to set a law.
Right.
So he had to live by the law.
Right.
And if they disobeyed that law, I know there are other places where people were killed. People were set to death, put to death for having broken the law. You'll agree with me?
Right.
There are other places where it says similar things. Not necessarily show no mercy, kind of hand. More serious in terms of people were killed.
For doing a kindly act, a helpful act. Saving a person's life.
Yeah.
If you break the law, Sabbath day you were not supposed to work. You picked up, they found you picking up firewood.
Yeah.
So according to the law,
punished for that.
Stone the man to death. Mm. They killed him. Right. I'm not contesting that. I'm contesting that, look, this woman is your benefactor. She saved your life.
Yeah.
See, by any means, suppose now somebody was grappling with me and I was killing me. And if you hit the guy too hard to save me and that guy died, you know, they can't hang you for that.
No, because I was just saving you.
Right. And the court case comes along, they said, look, this man was on the verge of dying, poor fellow. I saw him going blue in the face, you know, the guy was throttling him and I slapped him too hard and his eardrum broke and he died. You know?
Yeah.
I'm sorry for that. They can't hang you for that. They can't punish you for that. Now, God Almighty, we know He's a merciful God. He's kind and compassionate to the animals. Verse 4. Read verse 4 of the same chapter. Beautiful. Read verse 4 of the same chapter. Read it aloud.
Do you not, verse from 25, chapter 25, do you muzzle an ox when you're using it to thresh grain?
That's right. Beautiful. Now look. You see, the Jews were muzzling the mouth of the ox.
Yes.
When they're threading the corn, you see, they used to help the corn all put down and then the ox walks on it, so to loosen the grain. Mm. But in the process, the ox, poor thing, you know, will have a bite.
That's it. That's why they muzzled the ox.
No, they used to have a bite. So the Jew says, no, we shall not have a bite. So God is compassionate, is merciful to animals.
Okay.
He said, no, don't muzzle the ox. Let it have a bite. Man, how much can it eat? You know, while the thing is working whole day, it starts trying to get a few grains and the thing falls out of his mouth. He's got a few grains in the mouth. After half an hour, 15 minutes, it gives another bite. What damage is it doing? Be kind and compassionate to the animal.
Yes.
You know, don't muzzle the ox.
Yeah.
I can feel that the merciful God could have given that. You know, He's compassionate to animals as well as to human beings.
Okay.
But the same God, in 6 verses onwards, a woman who saves a man's life, chop off her hands. Now, I can't imagine the same God talking. It must be lunacy of the highest order. And you agreed that this is not God's word. If the God says chop off her hands, this can't be from God. It can't be the words of Moses. Unless Moses was also a lunatic. And it can't be from you. You can't say such a thing to anybody. So what I'm trying to demonstrate to you is this, that this is not the word of God. You see, the word of God must be consistent. You know, it must be for your benefit. Right? Now, a person who's done you a kind act, how can you go and chop off that person's hand? Then this book speaks about God in some filthy, dirty ways. It speaks about God Almighty that is riding little cherubs. You know what's a cherub? Cherub. You know,
so that he's?
Riding little cherubs.
Riding cherubs.
Yeah, cherubs.
The little angels.
Right. You see an angel, you see in the art gallery, when you see the pictures, Western art.
Yeah, I've seen the pictures.
You know, a beautiful woman, well proportioned with wings, you know, 36, 24, 36, with wings. But when you look at the art, she appears to be about 25, 30. A cherub is a 12-year-old thing, you know, just crisp, with a breast just sprouting now. That's a cherub. And God Almighty, His means of transport is riding cherubs from place to place. He rides on cherubs. You know that? He flies on the cherubs. How? How does He fly on cherubs? He's riding them on their back or on their stomach. You know, the cherubs are with wings. Is she flying like this and God is sitting on top of her, holding her by the breast to maneuvering her? Or does He, she's on her back and doing the backstroke with her wings? In your Bible, do you know that? God is riding little cherubs, little girls. Have you seen that? Have you seen that in your Bible?
Whereabouts is it? It's in the law again.
I give you just my son. Right. 2 Samuel 22:11. Read it, my son.
He flew swiftly on his winged creature.
Uh-huh.
He traveled on the wings of the wind.
Uh-huh.
That's it.
Right.
Oh, sorry.
Right.
He covered himself with darkness.
Right.
Full of water.
Now this winged creature, you see, this is now, read it in your Bible. This is one of yours. What is this winged creature?
Second Samuel 22.
He's not riding locusts or doves. What is this winged creature? 2 Samuel 11. 2 Samuel chapter 22 verse 11. Read it aloud, my son.
He mounted the cherubim and flew.
Aha, what is the cherubim? Cherubim, was it? What's the word there? He mounted the?
Cherubim.
What is cherubim?
Those angels that sing praises to him all day.
Right. So he's riding them.
Yeah.
Is this your God? My God.
It's his prerogative. If he has all the authority on earth to do what, on earth and in heaven to do what he wants.
The Quran tells us that God permeates the whole universe.
Yeah.
You see? He's nearer to you and to me than our jugular veins. To everybody, every creature, yeah. Whether you're on the Mars or Jupiter or the Moon, he is nearer to each and every one of us, nearer than our jugular veins. He doesn't need transport to move from here to Johannesburg or to America or there, and he uses young girls, 11-year, 12-year-old girls.
Who says a cherubim is a 12-year-old girl? Where'd you get this from?
Your dictionary, my son. Your dictionary.
You base their life on a dictionary anyway.
Wait a minute, look, man. Words, don't they have any meaning in your language?
Yeah,
words,
it doesn't mean every word in there is correct.
No. When the Bible says cherubim, yeah. What did the Jews understand?
Can we bring a dictionary? I want to see where it says cherubim. I've never looked up cherubim in the dictionary. It just seems like pretty preposterous to me.
It is preposterous. That God riding little girls. Mm-hmm. That's not the dictionary. I had the dictionary here. Collins dictionary.
No, this is a dictionary. It's larger than here.
It is. Collins, is it? Ah, right. I'm sorry. I couldn't see it, my son. Right. See, cherub. C-H-E-R-U-B. Cherub. Cherubim is plural. Cherub. C-H-E-R-U-B. C-H-E-R-U-B. Cherub.
Cherub.
Uh-huh.
Cherubs or cherubim. It's quite theological. Yeah. A member of the second order of angels, often represented as a winged child, an innocent or
sweet child. Winged child.
How old is the child?
I'm telling you, 11-year-old, 12-year-old.
How old is the
child? Or maybe 6-year-old.
So are you going to tell me a 6-year-old entering puberty?
No. Please. No. If he's riding cherubs, this God Almighty, for his transport. This is his transport.
Yeah,
riding cherubs. I said, that's little girls.
Does he do that all the time?
Whether
he's one instance here.
Whether you commit adultery once,
he
or you be 300.
He mounted cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. Once he did it.
No.
And that was this is a song of praise, man. Okay. It was written by a man who was not perfect.
But the who dictated it? Did God dictate that? Is it the word of God?
As translated by man, yes.
Is the word of God, that means now he did say cherub, that he riding cherubs even once. If you have intercourse with a prostitute once, you are an adulterer. Go on, am I right?
Sorry, say that again.
If you commit adultery with an adulteress once,
yeah.
You are an adulterer.
Okay.
If you do it 365 days of the year, you are still an adulterer.
Yeah.
Right. God Almighty riding cherubs.
That is, please. Right. Sorry, that is
okay.
A bad example.
Now, look, go on, before you go. I give you a warning. For example,
yeah.
I said, look, there's a box there.
Yeah.
And if you look into the box, you'll be a dead man. I'll chop off your head.
Okay.
Right. But not only you, there are 50,000 people here. And I tell them all, I said, look, anybody looks into that box, I'll chop off your head. Right. Now, you are the first guy. You know, inquisitiveness. Man is inquisitive by nature.
Curious.
You looked into the box. And I can't forgive you. So I chop off your head.
Okay.
It is harsh. It is cruel.
But
you, as soon as I said, go ahead. What? I said, sorry, sir, I forgot. Please, Father, my Lord, forgive me. Am I right? I should be forgiving. I said, okay, look out. Warning to the rest of you. But if I want to make you an object lesson, I chop off your head.
Yeah, sorry.
Right. But in that case, I'm saving 50,069. There are 50,070 here, people.
Yeah.
But I allow each and every one of you to pass. Each and every one of you to look into the box. It might take a week, single file, to look into that box. 50,070
Yeah.
The merciful God, he waits for all the 50,070 to pass, look into the box, and he kills them all. He widows 150,000 women, and he orphans 100,000 children. Is that the work of a merciful God? If you did that, Sean, I say you're a bloody, I don't know, you're worse than Hitler. Am I right? Hitler incinerated 6 million Jews. His hatred for the Jews.
Yeah.
He had his logic. His evil logic he had in doing what he did. But God Almighty, the merciful God, the loving Father in heaven, will he slaughter 50,070 persons for looking into a box?
No, of course not.
Well, read. Read your Bible. Open. 1 Samuel 6:19. 1 Samuel 6:19. Chapter 6, verse 19.
Yeah, I'll read it.
Right, read it loud, please.
The Lord killed 70 of the men of Beth Shemesh because they looked inside the covenant box, and the people mourned because the Lord had caused such a great scourge among them.
Right. Now, 50,070, your book says here. Your Bible says 50,070. 50,070.
Why
did
you say
50,000? Huh? See, open this book of yours, this Bible of yours. That's a damn cheat, man. Cheating. From 50,000 they come to 70 now.
Oh, why don't, maybe this is 50,000.
Huh? Are you reading correctly?
It's in gold. Just checking here.
This 1 Samuel chapter 6 verse 19. Did it last?
Yeah, okay, yes.
How many?
1,070. Yeah, this is right as well. This is 50,070.
Is it there 50,000?
It says here...
No, this one, you read only 70. You read only 70 there.
No, I'm explaining why I got it wrong. But God struck down some of the men of Beth Shemesh, putting 70 of them to death because they looked into the ark of the Lord. But
70 again?
Next to 70, just next to 70 it says double. Oh. And then at the bottom, a few Hebrew manuscripts, most Hebrew manuscripts in, I don't know the word, Septuagint.
Right.
50,070. So right. It's probably the same, right. As they've just used the same.
What is it?
Know, same again.
What?
50,070.
50,070. Now I ask you, is this the quality of a merciful God, the loving Father in heaven?
If you look at God in the Old Testament,
God is God. He's an unchanging God. He doesn't change. He's a loving Father. Is he loving only after 6,000, 4,000 years after Adam? He becomes a loving Father, or was he a loving Father from the beginning? Is he a loving God from the beginning, or he became a loving Father? He acquired this quality.
Have you heard of a little saying called "spare the rod and spoil the child"?
I appreciate that, but now, man, you make an object lesson. I don't spare the rod. So the first guy, if I want to be kind to the 50,069, the first guy I chop off his head.
Yeah.
But I'm saving, that's common sense.
50,069.
I'm saving 50,069. Okay. But if I am a sadistic God, you know, I watch as I do. How many? Come on. Thousand.
Until 50,000.
10,000, 20,000, 30,000, 40,000, 50,000, and 1, 2, 50, 60, 69, 70, the whole bang lot, and then I kill them all. Now, is that sanity? Is that what I'm trying to do?
I don't question God. God knows better than... God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. He knows...
Does he do silly things? Your God, does he do silly things?
I don't question him.
Does he do silly things?
I don't question him.
Does he do silly things, your God?
It might seem silly to me, but maybe it was purposeful for
him. Does he sleep with little children? No. Does he have sex?
No.
Why not? Can't he do that?
Because he's a spirit being and he's omnipotent, all-powerful.
But a spirit being, does he need a vehicle of riding?
You really do.
A spiritual being, he kills 50,070 persons for looking into a box. Is it such a crime? But Lot, he committed incest with his daughters. He didn't do anything. You know that? Lot. Reuben, he had sex with his mother. God said nothing. Right, Judah had intercourse with his daughter-in-law, and he had bastard children, the great grandfathers of your God, Jesus Christ. children of incest.
Well.
Children of incest. Your great great grandfather of your God. In Samuel, he talks about one of the sons of David raping his sister. God said nothing. The other guy, he rapes 10 of his father's wives wholesale, and God said nothing. But for a guy looking into the box, he goes and kills 50,070 persons. Is this in the book of God? Is this God
okay.
talking?
Please try this in the bin. I renounce Christianity, man. Yes, you really. You just.
Thank you.
I don't question God. He is my Almighty Father.
Thank
he
you,
has
son.
Given me salvation.
No, thank you very much. Now you have to become a Muslim.
I don't question God. He is my Almighty Father.
Thank
he
you,
has
son.
Given me salvation.
No, thank you very much. Now you have to become a Muslim.
Not a chance.
No, you have renounced Christianity.
I will.
You can't become a Hindu.
I will never renounce the name of Jesus Christ.
No.
He is my Lord
you
and Savior.
You said you renounced Christianity. You said throw this into the bin. And
I was just using it as an example.
No, I do not. That's what I said, that you are being in mental masturbation. This is mental masturbation.
I don't agree with you.
No, this is mental masturbation, my son.
You
said just now, clearly, I didn't force you. You said throw this into the bin. I renounce Christianity. Did you say that?
No, but
did you utter the words?
Yes.
Did you utter the words?
Yes.
These are words of blasphemy. You uttered them.
My God will forgive me. He loves me.
Jesus said, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost will never be forgiven.
I
not in this world,
Holy
nor
Ghost.
In the next. So in other words, now you have God as a witness. You told me this. I said, throw this into the bin. I threw it into the bin. And he said, I renounce Christianity. Now the choice is for you. Either you accept this book. Man is all, can't you see? After man, father raping, father having sex with his daughters, son with his mother, father-in-law with his daughter-in-law, brother with his sister.
What does it say in Romans 3:23?
One of the sons with his 10 mothers in a row.
What does it say in Romans 3:23?
I want to know whether this is the word of God.
What does it say in Romans 3:23?
What does it say?
For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Therefore, no one is perfect. Therefore, they will sin. They have no choice but to sin.
No. Your book contradicts him. Luke contradicts him. Everybody hasn't sinned.
Everybody
Jesus,
has sinned.
No. Jesus said he's come for the sinners.
Yeah,
right,
so.
Right. So look.
So I have my Bible back. I'm going to throw it in there.
No, that's over now. That's over.
No, but I could have my Bible back.
No.
I must have it back.
No, you said throw it into the bin.
Okay, could I have
right.
it back?
No, you can't.
Why not?
No, you gave it to me.
I didn't give it to you.
You gave it to me to throw it into the bin.
Well, could I have it back?
No, you can't. You can't.
Please.
No, you can't.
Can I get on my knees?
No.
Please, no, I must have that back.
No,
my mom, dad gave it to me.
Look. We'll speak to my secretary. Right, here.
Okay, I hope this was sufficient for you, eh? Okay, man. Thank you,
Brian. Ibi, look, I want you to be the judge now. I showed him things from the Bible about God riding cherubs.
Yes.
Right? He's got, God can do anything. I said, damn it all to ride little girls, He's got no other way means of transportation. Then he killed 50,070 guys, for looking into a box. Mm. And all this incest and rape in the Bible. He said, I renounce Christianity and throw this my Bible into the dustbin. Did you tell me that?
I was pumped. So
so he gave me the Bible.
Read cherubim there.
Cherubim.
There, just read it.
Cherubim.
Out loud, please, if you would.
Right. It's a theological term, a member of a second order of angels, often represented as a winged child. Second meaning, an innocent or sweet child.
Where does it mention girl? Where does it mention sex or gender?
So it's a male boy.
No.
No, the child. Is this child? What child can be a boy or a girl?
Yeah.
Right.
Doesn't
so he could be riding little boys. Is he riding little boys if not girls?
Doesn't say either. That's not.
No. He says children. He's right.
You jumped in to presume that he's riding little girls. So then you say, but then he's probably raping them as well.
You're a Western artist. Every angel that you see is a woman angel in your works of art. Am I right? You go to the art gallery, man. Durban Museum Complex. Have you been there?
Yes, years ago.
Right.
When I was
you go pay a visit now, and you see all the angels that you see in the art.
Yeah.
They are all women, well proportioned with wings.
Yeah.
Right. If you go to the Holy of Holies, St. Peter's in Rome. I've been there.
Yeah.
St. Peter's in Rome. And they have two cherubims in flesh-colored marble, absolutely naked.
Yeah.
And they appear to be about 12 to 14 year old, with the breast just sprouting.
Yeah.
Absolutely naked.
Sorry.
And they say these are the cherubims. Cherubim is the plural of cherub.
Yeah.
There's a woman, there's not a male.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not a male boy.
Yeah.
It's a girls, beautiful girls.
Mm-hmm.
This one here, child, when you see the pictures of this child angel, does that child angel look like a boy or a girl? You have seen men in your works of art.
So you are basing everything on presuming that a cherubim, that cherubim that you saw at St. Paul's as a girl, on one man's interpretation of cherubim.
No, your interpretation, if it's a boy...
No, not my interpretation. I do not perceive...
Okay, but what is the point?
What is the point?
Is that whether
it's a boy or a girl?
Make it any...
difference.
No, because what Mr. Dida said was, in a lot of ways I will agree with you that it seems pretty, not absurd, but odd that God would use cherubims after saying he's omnipresent, you know, in where David writes the song.
We accept that. I'm telling you myself that he permeates the whole universe.
Yeah.
He doesn't need helicopters to move around.
Well, obviously.
So he's everywhere. He's present.
Yeah.
But now when he writes cherubims, whether it's a boy child or a girl child, damn it all, is just as ridiculous. To write a boy child is worse.
Your point was that...
To write a boy is worse. He's giving the sodomists. You're in America, there's 25 million. He's giving them a cue that you can write boys now, little boys. Damn it all. No.
He's taking the whole song of praise that David wrote out of context. You're taking one verse and taking it out and then putting it in an entirely different context and calling
what
it
wrong. What is the writing a cherubim? What is the context? Killing those 50,070. And on that note, you said, look, I renounce Christianity and throw this into the dustbin.
I did that out of frustration because you've taken the Bible out of
So I congratulated him and said, now it calls for a conversion.
I will not convert to Islam.
No, then to Judaism or Hinduism. No. Become a Hindu, if you like.
I'm not a religious person. I don't want to call myself a whatever. Jesus Christ has set me free. I mean, I was involved in...
Free from what? Free from what?
From Satanism, from drugs, from this...
You were committing adultery.
Eh?
You were committing adultery before you joined the church. Before you were born again.
Yes, I was.
Right, you were an adulterer.
That's one thing I never did.
What, you sodomized boys?
No.
Then what did you do? What horrible thing did you do?
I think that, you see, this is... we don't have a problem with the teachings of Jesus Christ. Peace be upon him. The problem is that what Mr. Didat is showing you is his teachings got perverted. And then that is where the problem is, because his true teachings are not being followed by the Christian. Jesus said, do not eat pork.
Right. He never ate it in his life. None of his disciples ever ate this flesh of swine.
Jesus said circumcision.
Yeah.
How did Jesus pray? The manner in which he prayed?
You're not circumcised the way he was circumcised.
Well, look at circumcision, for example. I've looked at circumcision. I came close when I was 16. I was going to be circumcised.
Right.
But I just... I looked at circumcision and I said, okay, you know circumcision is fulfillment of the law.
Right.
Or for Jews. Okay, in terms of who I am as a person, socially, I'm not Jewish. And I didn't say, well, I'm not Jewish.
What God says, that the law he gave, circumcision, is only for the Jews? Because Jesus said...
Romans, yes.
Jesus says, not Jesus, your God. He says, think not that I'm come to destroy the law of the prophets. I am come not to destroy,
but
to fulfill.
But that's not the point.
So to fulfill means to fill up, not to take out. In your language, fulfill means to fill up, not to take out.
Yeah,
and
complete.
And he said, whosoever shall break one of these least commandments. Circumcision was not the least among the Jews. It was a major commandment. God Almighty.
I'm not Jewish.
God, but you follow a Jewish God. Your God is Jew. All his disciples were Jews.
Jewish.
Your God Jesus was a Jew.
Yeah, Jesus was Jewish because he was born to a Jewish family.
So your God is Jew, damn it all, and all his disciples were Jews, 12 out of 12, 100%.
Yeah.
Right? So now you're following a Jewish code of laws, but now you have perverted.
I no longer live by the law because Christ has set me free by his blood.
Now, did Jesus say that?
Yes.
Where? Show me.
Your concordance, because I'm not going to find it here.
But one big step he took. He threw his Bible away and he renounced Christianity.
He's a frustrated young man. But I admire him. He's thinking.
That is a you've made me think yes. a lot. I really, I thank you for this.
No, I haven't done enough yet. I want to meet your pastor.
We actually don't play a numbers game, you know, that, you know, this month we converted so many people. And so that's not our
job.
Where we publish book, Mr. D, there's thoughts and so on. Just people must think, and people must follow what
it's
their
fantastic.
Heart says.
It's fantastic. Because I didn't come here to try and convert anybody.
Exactly.
This is purely out of an interest.
I find that one that's interesting, what Mr. D says.
I'm sure I think... is there, just very quickly, I read this book of yours.
Yes,
I find quite very interesting, this combat kit.
Yes,
it actually made me think last night when I was reading it, I was standing outside waiting for someone to pick me up, and there were some Jehovah's Witnesses walking across the road, walking into a block of flats. So
right.
It actually made me laugh
right.
myself. Well, not
right.
laugh myself, but
right.
just laugh to myself.
Right.
When Jesus was talking to the crowd at one time, they asked him, which is the greatest commandment? And he says, love the Lord your God. And then after that, it's love others as you love yourself. Is there anything equivalent in the Quran or in Muslim scripture?
Yes.
Because one thing I was quite curious was, I find, actually, it's really, I'm laughing at myself. It's really ironic when I spoke to Sam this morning, and you are the man who wrote all these books.
Yes.
I didn't realize I was talking to the author.
Yes.
How can you be so militant?
Jesus was militant.
I don't agree. He came in love. When they went to the Garden of Gethsemane...
I'm also doing it in love. By God. You see, look, I love you. Go up. But now, if it's my nature at times to roar, I'll be a hypocrite and start bleating like a goat.
Yeah.
You know, when I think, look, I have a point. So, I just can't... I'm natural.
Myself, you get...
Right. So now, I accept that. Jesus Christ also. You know, I said...
Yeah,
you wicked and adulterous generation, you generation of vipers, you whited sepulchres, you hypocrites, you fools,
yeah.
you damnation of hell. Now look, this is also, is a loving, to me, he's one of the meekest of prophets,
yeah.
one of the prince of
but
peace.
But he never prophesied.
He's so humble and so meek.
How do you call him a prophet when he never prophesied?
Who, Jesus?
Jesus never prophesied.
No, he did prophesy about himself. So what's going
no, that's the only time he prophesied. Can you call him a prophet from one prophecy?
No.
I prophesied over a friend and it came true. And there's no
John the Baptist.
Prophet.
John the Baptist? Do you accept he's the greatest of the Israelite prophets according to Jesus?
No,
Jesus said, among those born of women, there has not risen another greater than John the Baptist. Did he say that?
He said that's right.
Jesus said, among those born of women, there has not been born another greater than John the Baptist.
Yeah, well, you saw my prophets. Yeah.
That means the greatest of the Israelite prophets, John the Baptist. That's what he said.
Yeah.
And they were speaking tongue in cheek. You know, he had meant something else.
Yeah.
No, he said that. And yet, John, what did he prophesy?
He said, prepare you the way for that.
Yeah, the guy's there already. He's there. What is there to prophesy? He's there.
He didn't know that time, did he?
No.
Until that time in the River Jordan when he baptized Jesus Christ.
But still he didn't know.
He didn't know. Then there was only after that when the Spirit descended on
still
Jesus.
He didn't know.
He did it that time. I'm sure he must have known.
You see, what happens now, go on. You see, you're reading into the book. You see, when John the Baptist was in prison before his beheading.
Yeah.
Right. He sent his disciples to Jesus, wanting to ask him whether he is the person they are waiting for, the Messiah.
Yeah.
Or seek we another.
Yes, okay, I agree with you. So
right.
that,
so man, that means now, towards the end of his life, it appears that he didn't hear the voice from heaven. You see, if you hear the voice from heaven, God telling you, the voice of thunder, this is my son, hear ye him.
Mm.
Damn it all, after 5 years after that, or 6 months after that, or 5 days later, you are in prison.
And this is John you're talking about.
John, yes. And John says, he is not sure. He sends his disciples to verify from Jesus whether he is the person that they are waiting for.
Okay, I'll
that
agree.
Means now, in other words, this is Matthew thumb sucking from somewhere. This thing didn't happen.
You don't think that he was there at the time?
No. I said now all this is all concoctions of the story because if it is, it's not consistent. Because once you hear the voice of God telling you, hear ye him, listen to my son.
Yeah.
And then he's still not sure.
Where is that? Is it in Matthew as well, isn't it?
You see, that's why I said, look, if your priest was here, whether he's a priest or a barber, you know, when I'm talking to him, man, he should be able to visualize this book. And now everything that I'm telling you, I can open it and show it to you. But now, you're giving this 75-year-old man too much hard work.
Apologies. It's just, so I'm trying to learn everything as fast as I can, but I can't. I'm only a human after all.
You see, my son, I can also make excuses. I'm a 75-year-old machine. You know, I can't remember. Look, I could have given you a reference, blah, 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 just like that. I can't do that. I have to start looking. That means you're wasting my valuable time.
Yes, you see? I apologize.
And in other words, that you are showing ignorance of your Bible. You are ignorant. In other words, because if you refer to me, you say, look, Muhammad did such and such a thing, or the Quran says such and such a thing. Either I confirm it, or when I deny it, it's not there. I said, look, nothing like that in my book. You see? So if you show me, I should be prepared to have my head chopped off, you know, under the guillotine. I said, that means now I'm prepared to become a Christian. If you show me what you are telling me in my Quran, I'll become a Christian. Like, for example, he says, the Quran condemns Trinity. The Quran. It says, وَلَا تَكُولُوا ثَلَاسَ. Don't say Trinity. إِنْتَهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. This is, stop it, it'll be better for you. إِنَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. For your Allah is one Allah, he's not three in one. That's what the Quran says. But suppose you told me, he said, look, your Quran does say about Trinity, that you have to believe in Trinity. So I tell you nothing like that in my book, my son. So he told me, look, uncle, if I show you in your book, then I said, look, I'll become a Christian. Fair? Yes. If you can show me in my book that I'm so cocksure about my book, that there's no such thing, because it's to the contrary. He said, don't say Trinity. Don't believe in Trinity. This is, stop it. This is not the teaching of God, that He is the triune God. See? And that verse, the first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 7, is also thrown out of the Revised Standard Version. Do you know that? In all the modern translations, thrown out as a fabrication.
What, Trinity?
Yes. For there are three that bear record in heaven.
See, the Trinity has never been in the Bible anywhere.
Right, right. So now, in other words, now the Christian world are Trinitarians, unless you are not.
Well, I've looked at the Trinity, and can I just quickly explain the way I see it?
Yes, my son.
In the beginning, like it says in Genesis, just pass my Bible, please, can I read that in my Bible?
No. I can tell you. It says, let us create man. Us.
No, I wasn't referring to that.
In the first verse of the Bible, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
Yeah.
The word God there in Hebrew is Elohim. And Elohim means gods. Did you know that? Oh, Elohim means gods. Literally, the word Elohim in the Hebrew language means gods.
Yeah.
But you translate it as God, singular. Though in Hebrew it is plural. So, the clever guy who wants to prove Trinity, he tells me that, look, you see, that word is plural. And in Hebrew, there are three, there's singular, dual, and plural.
Yeah.
Two and more is plural. Two or more. So they have a verb, a noun for singular. The same thing, dual, if you're
plural. Two,
and plural. There are three different words, singular, dual, and plural.
Well, is this Hebrew?
Hebrew and Arabic. We have three types of singular, dual, and plural.
Hebrew, there's no word, there were no, what do you call it, words like a and the.
I don't know.
Ancient Hebrew writings, then there's never anything like that. That's what I've been told by a guy who's a historian on it.
You see, the singular, so the word there, Elohim, is plural.
Okay.
Right. So this is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I says, no. You see, Eastern languages, including my own, we have two types of plurals. We have plural of numbers and plural of respect. In Arabic, in Hebrew, in my language Urdu, Gujarati, in every language of the East, we have two types of plurals.
Yeah.
You see, when I ask you in my language your name, I will say, aapka kya naam hai? Aap in Urdu means all. But I'm asking, what is thy name? But I don't say thy, I say, tera kya naam hai? It sounds disrespectful. Because now if I ask you, what is thy name? So you ask me back, what is thy name? So I don't want you to talk like that.
Yeah.
So I want to teach you how to talk respectfully. So I said, aapka kya naam hai? What is the name of you all? But you understand I'm talking about you.
Singular.
But I use the word
in respect.
Plural, you see. So you will ask me in turn, aapka kya naam hai? What is your name, all your name? So I'll tell you my name is Ahmad. Right? So I'm trying to teach you respect by using plural of respect. In the Quran also we have the same thing. The Quran says, "Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun," that it is for us to send down the revelation and it is for us to protect it.
Salaam.
So you might want to know. So you might want to ask, is it this us in the Quran? Who is this? Muhammad, Gabriel, and God? I said, no. Says who? I said, God. But he said, it is us. Says, we have created the heavens and the earth. Who is this we? Muhammad, Gabriel, and God? I said, no, it's God. But he said, it says we. Who is this we? I said, no, in our language, there are two types of plurals. We use this plural of respect for God. We use we and us, we meaning the one and only.
Yeah.
See? So now similarly in the Hebrew language, the same position. But now you in your language, because you didn't have it, you didn't have that. So now you are now picking up from a Jewish book, you know, Jewish terminology, metaphors and similes,
yeah,
and you're trying to understand it literally. That creates the problems. Like Son of God. I'm asking the Christian, how many sons has he got?
One.
You see, that's the answer. Everybody says. But I said, you haven't been reading your Bible. You see, in the book of Genesis, chapter 6, verse 3, it says, and the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them to wife all that they chose. Verse 4 or 6. So, and when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and had sex with them, and bore children to them, they became great men of old men of renown. How many sons did he have? Many. Then in the book of Exodus, God says, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. In the book of Jeremiah, he says, Ephraim is my son, even my firstborn. In the book of Psalm, God speaks to David, and he says, I will declare a decree unto thee, that thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And in the New Testament, we are told, as many as are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Meaning, every Tom, Dick, and Harry, if you follow the will and plan of God, you are a godly person. In the language of the Jew, you are a son of God.
Yeah.
So, you said just now that God has only one son, whereas he's got sons by the tons in your Bible. But you are ignorant. You are like a donkey with the blinkers on. You are only made to see that one and you don't see all the others. He's got them sons by the tons. Solomon is his son. Adam is his son in your Bible. And Adam the son of God. But you didn't read that. So,
could any of the sons of God that you just spoken about, all these sons in Genesis and Exodus, did any of them do what Jesus did?
What did Jesus do? What did he do?
All the miracles that he did while he was alive, and then he was crucified.
Jesus says miracles are no proof that the man is even a true prophet of God. He said, Jesus says, for there shall arise many false prophets and false Christs who will show you great signs and wonders.
Yeah.
If it were possible to deceive the very elect, his chosen ones, even yeah, they can be deceived. So if a false prophet, if a false Messiah can perform miracles, it is not a test of a true one. So come on now, what?
That's what Jesus, talking about prophets these days.
So this is what Jesus was talking about.
Right.
So if the false prophets can perform miracles,
yeah,
it is not a test. And John the Baptist, I told you just a little while ago, that he was the greatest of the Israelite prophets, but he performed no miracles. According to Jesus, he is the greatest. Greater than Moses and
prophet,
David and Solomon.
Yes, but Jesus was not a prophet.
What was he? What was he?
He was the Messiah, the Son of God.
Now, what is a Messiah? What is a Messiah? What does Son of God mean? What does Son of God mean? You see, I said, look, you don't know the Hebrew language, my son.
He has been created from God, a part of God, set aside, so that he can come down to earth and redeem all mankind of all the sin and hatred and the anger. And
was he born in the stable to a Jewish girl?
Yes.
But you say he came from heaven. How did he come from heaven?
What do you call it? Divine, I don't know, the fancy words.
No. Look, did he come out of his mother's womb with all the filth and the muck that made his mother impure for 7 days? According to Luke, she had to be purified. Do you know that? Luke, man,
yes.
Chapter 3. She had to be purified from the childbirth. That means the pure and holy God coming into the world makes his mother impure. Does it make sense? Pure and holy God being born makes his mother impure. Does that make sense to you?
I don't know if you're taking impure a little bit out of context.
No, did he come out of his mother's womb?
Mm-hmm.
Because Luke tells us when he was 8 days old, he was circumcised and named Jesus by the angel when he was in his mother's womb.
Yeah.
Was he in his mother's womb?
Yes.
Right. How did he come out from there?
Well, by normal.
Same like you and me.
Yeah.
Right. Suppose you were in this 2,000 years ago. and this helpless little creature was coming out of his mother's womb and you're helping. A male nurse, you. Can you for one moment think that's your Jehovah coming out of the womb? Your God that? Can you for one moment think that that is your God coming out of the womb with all the filth and the muck?
And if he'd arrived on a silver and gold chariot, come down in storms of fire, would you have believed he was God?
Of course you would have. Man, damn it all, you have conquered the world. And everybody would have bowed down to him. But he came out of
that
a woman's...
It's so simple, that's what God could have done.
You see, the thing is this, now he was born of a woman's womb, like anybody else. He was circumcised on the eighth day. The Bible says that.
Yeah.
Circumcised. You know what circumcision, of course, you know.
Yeah.
You were nearly circumcised.
Yeah.
But if you were really circumcised, you would have remembered at the age of 16. You see, they have to catch you by your... There's nobody can circumcise a child without holding the little child by his...
Yeah.
And to loosen the skin.
Foreskin, right?
Foreskin. And circum means right round, and size means to cut. To cut it off. But you can't do that with your mouth. You can't say circumcise and the guy gets circumcised. You have to catch the little boy by his... Somebody had to hold your God, Jesus, by his... To circumcise him.
Yeah, so.
Your God, somebody holding you by his...
He came to earth as a man, for crying out loud.
Damn it, hey. Look, go on. If you, God gave you the power to become a cockroach. Suppose,
yeah.
And you chose a little experiment. You're going to have a little fun. Huh?
Yeah.
You become a cockroach and start running around. And I managed to crush you.
Yeah.
Can anybody charge me for murder?
No, of course not.
Why not?
Because you didn't know you're standing on me.
Damn it all. Look, you chose to be a cockroach. You're a cockroach. I killed a cockroach.
Yeah, that's not, you killed a cockroach. You didn't kill me.
No, right. So the thing is, if God becomes a man, he's not God anymore. The person who's eating food and... No, if eating God and eating God, he can't be God.
Why not?
You believe in a God that eats God and an eating God?
I think you're being a little blasphemous now.
No, look, your Bible says that he is a spiritual being. He says,
yeah.
God is spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in truth and in spirit.
Yeah.
Right. So now you are telling me now that this is God. He used to eat food, your Jesus. He used to drink milk from his mother's breast. He used to wet his napkins. Your God waiting his napkins? Your God eating and...
Yeah.
Huh? And your God, you call him God? Man, how...
He's defeating the whole purpose of why he came to earth. He came to earth so that he could live as a man, be tempted as a man, through a period of time, and
he failed. Look.
He didn't fail, honestly,
look,
man.
Look, he destroyed those 2,000 pigs, do you remember?
Yeah, so?
Right. Now, look, go on you. If you can heal a man, you know, the transplant. See,
yeah.
The man needs a transplant of a pig's heart to save his life.
Yeah.
Do you kill 2,000 pigs to do that?
No.
Now,
heart.
Jesus Christ went to heal one person, he kills 2,000 pigs. Does that make sense to you?
He taken right out of context again.
What context?
Man was demon possessed. He said the demon isn't the pigs. What do you expect him to? You said he went to the man next door.
No. If he must, send him into one pig. Because if the... A million demons can be in one person, they can be transported into a one pig, can't they? A million demons can be occupied in your body.
Yeah.
Demons, I can take them out and put into a pig. Why should I?
Relevant. So what if you put them into 10 pigs or 1,000 pigs or one pig?
Look, those pigs belong to somebody. Didn't they? They didn't belong to the Jews.
I don't know.
No, look.
I think it's irrelevant.
What do you mean?
Isn't it relevant whether he's in a one pig or 20?
No, I think
2,000.
Seriously, is it a difference whether he sends it into one pig or 20 pigs?
Or 2,000? Or 2,000?
Agreed socially, you know, that man who owned those 1,000 pigs,
2,000
pigs,
right.
2,000. Agreed socially, that man who owned 2,000 pigs is now 2,000 pigs less.
Right. So that did Jesus reward the guy? Did he pay them for it?
Does it say he didn't?
He didn't, because they ran to the village and they brought a gang and chased him from there. Your God was chased out for destroying those 2,000 pigs.
And the man,
damn it, you're not reading your Bible.
And it was demon possessed. But
to save that man, you destroyed somebody's 2,000 pigs. You are a bloody loony, a vandal, man. Then he's hungry. Go on, he's hungry, and he runs to a fig tree. And he finds no figs, so he kills the fig tree. Does that make sense to you? He's a vandal, man. A man is a vandal. You go and destroy somebody's fig tree. Fig trees just didn't drop from heaven. Look, in season it would have borne fruit. It was out of season. Your God didn't even know when figs were in season or were not in season. You today, you go to a fruit shop and say, you want a bunch of leeches. They'll ask you, where did you come from? He said, I come from England. I said, no, sir, you see leeches around June, around December. Around Christmas time, you'll get leeches.
Yeah.
Right. So he said, oh, I'm sorry. I thought, you know, I've heard about leeches, so I asked. But you're a local man, and you go and ask for leeches, and there's no leeches there in the shop, and you punch the guy, and you upset his food. Then you are a loony man, you're a vandal. Jesus Christ, he goes and destroys a fig tree for not bearing fruit out of season. It's a lunacy of the highest order. He destroys somebody's pigs, 2,000. Then he calls his mother woman. He said, what have I to do with thee? My time is not yet. This is the same word he used for a prostitute. In his language, is there no word for mother? There's no word for mother in his language? What do you mean? Every human language, man, the first word that child utters is ma, mama.
Yeah.
And you mean to say in Hebrew there's no word for mother?
There probably is, I don't know.
No, no. Damn it all, the very next word, he says, woman, look at your son. And he tells the son, John, he says, look at your mother. He used the word mother. Right? So he knew the word mother. But now he uses the word woman for his mother, which is the same word he used for a prostitute. Does it befit a man of God? Addressing his mother, a woman. Is that how you call your mother? You call your mother your father's wife. Is that what you call her? What do you call her? Don't you call her ma? Mom? Huh? You don't call her father's wife? She's your father's wife. Isn't she? Your mother is your father's wife.
I hope so.
She is your father's wife. But you don't call her father's wife. You don't call her woman, do you? You won't call her a woman?
No.
No? But then this
I'm not Jesus Christ. I had no
so Jesus Christ has a right. The woman who carried him for 9 months.
Oh, he is God.
So she carried him. She was not a goddess.
Aren't those things being put into the Bible to show you that Jesus was not God?
That's it.
He was a prophet. Because if he was God, he would know that you would get fig on that tree.
Right.
I think those things are put in there. And I have looked, what little I've looked in the Bible, I have found nowhere where Jesus said, I am God, worship me.
No, that would have been, if I came, walked in this room today and said, I am God, worship me, you'd think I'm a nutcase. So
of course you would be a nutcase. You see, if he's God, then he's a bloody hypocrite. He's talking with tongue in cheek. If he's God, he must say, so I'm God. If you are God, then you're not afraid. My son, am I right?
Well, he's not afraid. He went to the cross.
That is crying like a woman. You remember? He's crying, he's wailing like a woman, he's crying in the garden.
Well, wouldn't you, if I told you at 3 o'clock this afternoon, you're going to be crucified?
No. For a cause.
If you're God, you wouldn't be.
If you're a God.
He came on earth as a man.
Servant of God.
He was a man.
There are millions.
Was wailing. He was
There are millions of Chinese who have gone to the slaughter with a smile on their faces. Lord Nelson, you heard about Lord Nelson, right? While he was dying, he said, thank God that I have done my duty. This man is crying, man, even on the cross he's crying. He said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? If God forsook him, that means he's an unbeliever. That's death. That is spiritual death. If God forsakes you, you are dead. You agree?
Yeah, spiritually.
Spiritually you are dead. And that's really the thing that matters. God told Adam, he says, the day that thou eatest the fruit thereof, thou shalt surely die. You remember?
Die spiritually, he did.
He didn't say that, but that's what he said.
No, but that's what he meant.
That's right. In other words, now spiritually you'll be separated from me.
Yeah.
Right. That means spiritual death. Spiritual death.
Yeah.
Jesus was separated from the Father spiritually. Spiritually he was dead.
Yeah.
That means spiritually he was an unbeliever. You see, when you're spiritually dead, you are an unbeliever.
I've seen that, but I don't agree with it.
If you are spiritually deprived from God, separated from God, you are dead. You are a kafir. You are a kafir. You are an unbeliever. If God separates from me, he rejects me, then I am an unbeliever.
Yeah,
You see?
I'm not going to renounce my Christianity.
That you didn't done already.
I hear what you're saying. My whole point to round up what you're saying is, I agree with you in a lot of ways. The Bible contradicts itself, or seems to contradict itself. My point is that the men that wrote the Bible were not perfect. I don't think God sort of sat down on the guy's shoulder and said, in his ear, okay, and then told him word for word what to write. I think if I see something happening in the street and I wrote an account of it, and that gentleman on the other side of the street saw the same thing and he gave an account, would our accounts be the same?
You see,
basically, maybe the general, the very, very basic general outline of the story would be the same.
Contradicting. You see, once you
they
are
don't contradict themselves.
No, listen, listen. The book says that Solomon had 4,000 stalls of horses.
Yeah.
Another guy says he's inspired by God. He says he had 40,000 stalls of horses. 4 and 40. Does that make a difference to you? Difference of 36,000. Do you know that?
Oh, can I?
Right. And now the Jews, they didn't know the zero. They didn't know the zero. They wrote it in words. They wrote 4,000 in Hebrew, F-O-U-R, 4.
Yeah.
They wrote 40, F-O-R-T-Y, 40,000.
Yeah.
There's a difference of 36,000. Who is inspired out of the two? Then this book says, one guy here, you read there, he says that guy is an Ishmaelite, another says he's an Israelite, the same fellow. But if I told you that Muhammad was a Jew, an Israelite, that guy tells you Muhammad was an Ishmaelite, an Arab.
But Ishmael is Ishmael.
The children of Ishmael are the Ishmaelites. The children of Israel are the Israelites.
Yeah, but I think Israel, what's the word? Ishmael, and someone else, Isaac.
Isaac.
Isaac. Yeah, it's the same person, eh?
No.
There was a poster downstairs at a cafe I saw, and it had all the Muslim names and then names in brackets all the other way around.
No, whatever that is.
Jacob was...
Yago.
Yeah.
No, that means that how we pronounce. We pronounce
Abraham,
as Yago. Yusuf.
Like
Yusuf. You say Joseph, we say Yusuf, is the same person, but that's the way of pronouncing.
Yeah.
Dialect, you see. But now, if I'm telling you that Jesus was an Arab, that guy said, you say Jesus was a Jew.
Yeah.
One of us is not speaking the truth.
Yeah.
In this case, we know who's not speaking the truth. I'm a liar.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
But suppose we didn't know about a fellow, and you said he was Jew, and I say he was an Arab.
Yeah.
Both of us could be liars. Both of us could be liars. Am I right?
Yeah.
But in our case about Jesus, you are speaking the truth and I'm speaking a lie.
Yeah.
Right. So now you open the book. Open the book. 1 Chronicle 2:17.
Mm-hmm.
It tells you that the guy they mentioned, he is an Ishmaelite. 2 Samuel 17, verse 25, it says he is an Israelite. Now, coming from the same God, does God know what he's talking about? Does he know the difference between Ishmaelite and Israelite? Does he know the difference? Does he know? God doesn't know. That means he's no God. He's some man sitting on some throne. He's telling you, sir, write down my son Jesus is a Jew. And he's telling that man, sir, write down my son Jesus is an Arab. Can you think what originates from the same God, both these statements?
And to say that one of those prophets that wrote that down was wrong?
Or both of them are wrong. One of them is wrong, definitely. That's your book. And I show you 100 like that. Jesus says, he says, of those that have given me, I have lost none. None means not one.
Not one.
Yeah. In the next chapter he says, of those that you have given me, I have lost only one. Now the difference between one and none.
Where is that?
John 17:12. John chapter 17 verse 12. John 17 12. Read it, my son.
While I was with them, I kept them safe by the power of your name, the name you gave me. I protected them, and one of them was lost except the man who was bound to be lost, so that the scripture might come true.
Right. The same John chapter 17, he says he lost only one, and here he says he has lost none. The difference between none and one, you know, how many percent is that?
I'm just going to read the context of this, because I actually read this long time ago. I don't remember it. Okay.
Just a look at the context.
I'm just going to write these two down. Yes. So I've actually got a lot of work to do, and I don't want to waste
me
your
too.
Time.
Me too. I'm also a very busy man, but I sacrificed my whole morning.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. 17.
That's stealing.
You see, you took that Bible out.
Yeah, no, it's my Bible.
That is stealing.
Stealing?
That is stealing, yes. You see...
Please, may I ask for my Bible back?
You took it from there, that is stealing. I just abstained myself for 2 seconds, and this is what you do. You are a man of spirit, a spiritual person. You said, I renounce Christianity. I'm quoting your words. And he says, throw this in the dustbin.
I was joking. I was frustrated.
No, that's what you said. Now you must be a man of your word. As a spiritual person, you had no right to pick it up. Okay. That was stealing.
Please, may I have my Bible back?
No. Give it to me.
I want my Bible.
No.
Yes.
Is
there a toilet I could go to quickly?
Yes. Moses, okay. Show him the toilet.
Thanks.
Mr. E.B. Lockhart.
So we were searching for...
We're just stopping you from going to Mars.
Yeah, we're going now, yes.
Okay.
You can join us, and then...
I want to go there, but the thing is, I've still got a lot of work left to do. I'm going to come some other time, soon.
You come about 12:30.
Half past 12.
And then prayer time, you can go down, watch, and come and have lunch with us.
Okay.
You'll enjoy the curry and rice as well.
Yeah.
You see?
I love curry.
We didn't offer you anything at all today. You said you had some tea, coffee before you came. But next time, curry and rice.
Okay, great.
Inshallah.
I'll come in the morning and make an appointment.
No, you don't have to make an appointment. You just come along any weekday. Yes. Come.
Okay. This is an unbelievable morning, man. This is like the time of my life. I really appreciate everything you've done for me.
Thank you.
And can I have my Bible, please?
No.
I need that Bible. No. My mom and dad gave it to me for Christmas.
The Christian, you see, I had another Christian from a university after one of my lectures in the city hall.
Yeah.
And he tells me, he said, look, I don't agree with you. But you have a right. What you don't agree with? He heard my lecture. He can tell me nothing. But I don't agree with you. See, Christ is the way. I said, look, man, his teachings, you can't practice them. He said, no, I can. I said, look, Jesus said, it has been said by them of old time, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, resist not evil. He who strikes you in the right cheek, give him the other.
Yeah.
So are you prepared to? That I strike you on the right cheek and you give the other.
Yeah.
He said, yes. Right. Come on.
No, I don't want to.
No. He said, right, he's prepared to.
Yeah.
That means he can follow Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Right? So I withdrew. That means he won the first round. See, I didn't really dirty my hands.
That's not so playing it.
Then I said, Jesus also said, he who comes to borrow of you till now. Right? He says, if a person takes away a coat, you give him a cloak also.
Mm.
Are you prepared to do that? He said, yes. He had a lumber jacket on. This is the lumber jacket. So he took it out. Yeah. I said, the jersey as well. The jersey he was wearing under the lumber. He took the jersey out. Then I said, no, Jesus said, he who comes to borrow of you, turn down not away.
So he who borrows...
He who comes to borrow of you, turn down not away.
Yeah.
Means respond to him, give it to him.
Good.
I said, how much you got in your pocket? I said, how much have you got in your pocket? He said, you need it. He said, I got, don't look at my suit. I said, I need it. Come, take it out. No, he couldn't. He couldn't. You see, now his religion went only up to so far.
Yeah.
That he was prepared to do. He was prepared to give his jacket, lumber jacket, and his jersey. Now I said, the money. Come on. Let's see how far you can follow him.
Yeah.
So, no. That he can't part with his money.
So this is
where
he could go.
Now he's about to go. He says, I want my jacket. I said, what for? Damn it all, you gave it to me. That means you're only scoring a point.
Yeah.
See? So I said, no. So the blooming fellow, he cried. I said, you won't get it. And he didn't get it. I said, I'll give it to the poor.
Yeah.
You won't get it. So in other words, now man, to me, a man is a man of his word. He said, right, I give my life, you must be prepared to give your life. Right.
Yeah, we're
going to
pray now. Right. We're locking the office. Yeah. I need my Bible. My mom and dad gave it to me, even if it has sentimental reasons.
Right, come, let's move.
You can't.
Come.
If you threw it away, it's gone.
He told me, throw it in the dustbin.
My mom and dad are going to kill me if I lose that.
Right. I can't help it.
Abdul Namaz, come and have lunch with you.
So you couldn't organize something with your dad, could you please?
Legal. Tomorrow, so coming tomorrow.
Okay, if I lose it, my mom and dad, they'll kick me out the house. Okay, so I got a prayer.
You lock up for prayer?
Yeah, no, I didn't.
Bible that he threw there and denounced Christianity. He said that he feels that if you can spare him the courtesy of giving him the Bible, you can feel free in talking to my father. Let me tell you, you don't get offended.
No, my loud speaking.
That's his
not
nature.
To frighten you.
No, I understand your position.
I talk, I shout, and all that. You know, that's what I do.
He treats you like a son. That's why he shouts. He treats like a son.
It's the same thing.
Father to a son. Thank you.
No, what I have a proposition for you. I don't want to deprive you of that Bible.
Okay, thank you.
There's one small condition.
Yes.
I want you to bring your pastor.
Okay.
To prove to me that the Bible is God's word. That's all.